continuing the tradition.
Goodbye.
Oh, my goodness. Touchdown. ABC Sports Championship Television. From the cornfields of Nebraska to the dust bowls of Texas, Big 12 country breeds football players. With three of the nation's top seven teams, hope runs high in the heartland. And tonight, two of the Big 12's best head east for their stiffest non-conference tests of the season. The Cornhuskers trek to Happy Valley, where Joe Paterno, coaching's all-time win leader, awaits. And the Longhorns travel down Tobacco Road, where Mack Brown makes his return with Steers in tow. Nebraska, Penn State, Texas, and North Carolina, next on ABC Sports.
College football continues on ABC. Some of you will see Joe Paterno in his two national championships take on Frank Solich, who's been there as an assistant. Others will see Mack Brown in Texas, burnt orange, make the return to North Carolina, where he was so terrific, 8 winning seasons, 6 bowl games in this one. And for teams that have national championship hopes, like Nebraska and Texas, key games here.
They have not been dominant this year. They don't just need to win. They need to win impressively and stay up high in the polls. That way, if they lose one down the road, they still have a chance to play in the national championship. Right.
This afternoon, there is a huge story emerging in Notre Dame. Fighting Irish off to a 2-0 start to the season. Look to go 3-0 for the first time since 1996. Hadn't scored an offensive touchdown. Ryan Grant, 3 yards out. They got a couple today. Their defense is great there.
Well, their defense keeps them in their games, and now they're beginning to understand this West Coast offense. They're scoring points with their offense.
Well, Shane Walton sealed the victory against John Navarro, so they're 3-0. Michigan State next week are on ABC. Washington State and Ohio State. Maurice Claret has been the best freshman in the nation. 3 yards out for a touchdown here. He would finish with 230 yards on the day, 194 of those yards coming in the second half. And gets another touchdown there. USC against Colorado. Carson Palmer to Malai Fo-McKenzie. And watch him run out of a tackle right there. Steps back. Another one just shows the power. Then gets it to the end zone for the touchdown. 40-3. USC gets the big win over Colorado. Throughout the day, we, of course, will keep you up to date on all of the other games being played. We also will see you at halftime. Up next, some of you get Texas, North Carolina. Others get Penn State and Nebraska. We'll see you again later.
Thank you, John, and welcome everybody to Chapel Hill, North Carolina, where tonight the North Carolina Tar Heels play host to the number 2 team in the nation, the University of Texas Longhorns. Good evening, everyone, and welcome. I'm Sean McDonough, delighted to have you with us. Obviously, the backdrop for this game is the return to Chapel Hill of Coach Mack Brown. For 10 years, he walked the sidelines here in Keenan Stadium as the head man of the North Carolina Tar Heels. They had some of their best seasons here under his direction. For the last 5 years, he's been the head man for the University of Texas Longhorns. And in anticipation of this game, the largest crowd ever at Keenan Stadium will be on hand. They've added over 1,000 temporary seats to accommodate the demand for tickets for this big ball game. I'm joined this afternoon and evening by David Norrie. And David, Texas talking openly about a national championship. You get the sense the talent level now is such that if they don't win it all, the season will be a disappointment. If they do win it all, Chris Sims is going to need to have a good year.
Well, I think Chris Sims is the individual focal point in the BCS race. He alone will determine whether this team plays for the national championship. And I think the way he bounces back from his performance in the Big 12 championship game is going to really be the key. Last fall, he lined up against Colorado. His teammates were hitting on all cylinders, and he had a nightmare of a second quarter. 3 turnovers, had a turnover in the first quarter, did not give his team a chance to go to the Rose Bowl. But he's back this year. He has all the weaponry around him. He's got the maturity. He's throwing the ball better. Sean, I love this team. If Chris Sims can respond, I love this team to play Miami for the national championship in the Fiesta Bowl.
And much of the attention here, obviously, on Mack Brown. The Carolina head coach is Tar Heel alum and former terrific linebacker John Bunting in his second season as head coach here. Moments ago, he spoke to his team.
Guys, I'm not going to ask you to do anything else than what you've been doing the last 2 weeks. Play the whole game. Keep your head up the whole game. There will be hard times. There will be adversity we'll have to overcome. There will be. But I'm going to ask you to do it again. I want you to turn to your left or turn to your right and tell that guy you're going to sell out for him. Tell him. Tell him you're going to sell out for him. Tell him you're going to sell all the way out for him.
Well, certainly John Bunting brings an energy and passion to his job. He also has a terrific quarterback in this game in Darian Durant.
Yeah, he's very underrated. Darian Durant, he's a great pocket passer, a spot thrower. His big forte, he can throw the deep ball. And he's got a lot of targets down the field. Big tight ends, a very talented wide receiver in Sam Aiken. The key to the ballgame tonight, can he get the time against this talented front seven for Texas? This North Carolina team is capable of springing an upset. And the only other team you have to ask about that is Florida State, Sean. They got upset last year here.
They came in here ranked number 6 last season and left with a 41-9 defeat. Mack Brown back in Chapel Hill to kick off in a moment.
Rated E.
In 10 seasons at North Carolina, Mack Brown led a complete turnaround of the Tar Heel program, taking the Heels from 1-10 in his first year to 10-1 in his last. Then it was on to Texas, where Brown inherited a program coming off a 4-7 season. The turnaround was immediate, as the Longhorns have celebrated at least 9 victories in each of Brown's first 4 seasons. All in all, 12 consecutive winning seasons for Mack Brown, dating back to his days at Carolina. Yesterday, he spoke about his return to this stadium.
I'm excited that Carolina's got the largest crowd in school history tonight. How neat. It's fun to look at these facilities and remember when we got here in 88, how they looked, and to see what's happened to this place. So nervous night for me. It's not worried about somebody being mad at me coming back. Some of those people were mad at me while I was here.
One concern for both sides will be the weather. It is 74 degrees, but very humid. The barometer 30.16 and steady. The dew point is 72 to go with that 94% humidity. There is the possibility of rain. We had heavy rain here this morning and into the early afternoon, but it has held off for the last few hours. Topher Roberts kicks off. Carolina won the toss and deferred, so Texas elected to receive the opening kickoff. Selvin Young, the true freshman, will take an E about 7 yards deep. The atmosphere electric. A big game for Chris Sims among his missions this season to prove that he can win the big game. That's been a criticism of Chris throughout his career in Austin, now a senior. Last season, a single season Texas record, 22 touchdown passes. He is 16-4 in his career as a starter, including opening night this season 2 weeks ago, a 27-0 shutout of North Texas.
And even though they played North Texas 2 weeks ago, this is his first big test since the Big 12 championship game.
Cedric Benson carries for 7 out to the 27-yard line. The Alamo Rent-A-Car starting lineup for Texas. Benson, who rushed for more than 1,000 last year as a freshman, with Tristle the blocking fullback. Great wide receivers in Johnson and Williams. Chad Stevens starts at tight end. The Horns got off to a quick start against the Mean Green of North Texas, scored all 27 points in the first half, then went to sleep in the second half with the comfortable lead. Benson stopped just short of the first down. It's a remade offensive line this week for Texas as a result of the struggles in the opener against North Texas. Bo Baker was a backup. He now starts at right guard. Derek Dockery, who was the starting guard, has moved out to tackle. The defensive front for Carolina, Chapman, their best player and only returning starter among the front seven, with Coates, Page, and Mooring. Third down and 1. Extra tight ends into the ball game, and a first down for Benson. Following the lead block of the fullback, Matt Tristle, Clay Roberson, and Dexter Reed made the tackle for North Carolina. The rest of the defense, they're very inexperienced at linebacker. Devlin Bullard, Doug Justice, and Malcolm Stewart are the starters, but Stewart has a tenuous grip on the starting position. They're looking for more. An outstanding secondary. Michael Waddell and Kevin Knight among the best corner tandems in the country. And Chris Curry and Dexter Reed, their leading tackler, are the safeties. Reed will be all over the field. He's made 35 tackles in the first 2 games. First and 10 Longhorns. Benson
Taken down by Dante Coates for a gain of one.
Now, Sean, with all the inexperience along this North Carolina defensive front and the linebackers being as suspect as they are, we're going to see a lot of Dexter Reed, number 24, the strong safety, getting involved up near the line of scrimmage. North Carolina has to stop this Texas running game, stop Cedric Benson first, and then hope these corners hold up on the outsides against the talented wide receiver corps.
It's a very big offensive line and inexperienced defensive front. Many thought that Texas would come out and just try to play smash mouth football. Now Sims trying to throw for the first time, stumbled and fell down back at the 26-yard line. A loss of 9 on the play. Devontae Coleman was in pursuit. Will Chapman also applying pressure. And they'll need a big night from both of those gentlemen. Coleman plays a lot of nickel situations for John Bunting.
And John Bunting's defense getting a name for timing their blitzing, timing their movement at the snap of the football. And if you talk to defensive coordinators across the country, they say really the only way you can successfully defense Chris Sims is to not let him get comfortable in the pocket. You've got to get him confused and distort the picture.
Brett Robin, the lone back. He's a third down specialist. Blitz and a screen to Robin. Has running room and a first down across midfield. Britt Robin all the way down inside the 35-yard line. Michael Waddell knocked him out. A great call by Greg Davis, the offensive coordinator, and beautifully executed a 48-yard gain.
Yeah, you hit the nail on the head, Sean. This is a great call. You see blitzing. You see the extra defender at the line of scrimmage. Use that aggressiveness against the defense. The pass is dropped off on the screen, and Robin, a great job of getting the ball up the sideline for yardage.
They spotted the ball back at the 31, so officially a 42-yard gain. First and 10 from the Tar Heel 31. Tony Jeffrey, a reserve wide receiver, was the motion man from the bottom of your screen. Very little running room for Cedric Benson. Yesterday, we spoke with Mac Brown about the pressure on Chris Sims.
He's in more control of the huddle. He knows the offense better, and he seems much more comfortable to me right now. He had his first 9 passes against North Texas and really didn't throw a bad ball all night. Took a couple of sacks to keep from throwing a bad ball, and he's matured a lot, and I expect him to have a great year.
He seems to be a bit more in command, particularly given there's no longer any debate about who the quarterback should be with the graduation of Major Applewhite. Here's Cedric Benson. There's also no debate about who the tailback should be. 17 yards on the rumble. Kendall High, a defensive tackle, had to make the stop well downfield at the 11-yard line. It'll be first and 10. Horns marching impressively on the first drive of the game.
Yeah, Cedric Benson is one of the most impressive young running backs you'll see in the country this year. A freshman of the year offensively in the Big 12 Conference. And the teammates vote at Texas who the offensive MVP is. Last year was Sims, Mike Williams, Roy Williams in the lineup. Benson was the MVP.
Great block by the fullback Trissel on the last play to help spring Benson. Trissel was lined up offset on this play. Benson driving through the tackle, finally pulled down by Doug Justice, the redshirt freshman from Port Orange, Florida. Benson already 7 carries. He says he'd like to average 30 per game. 43 yards for Benson. He's almost equaled his total for the entire first game against North Texas when he rushed for only 49 yards.
Well, he doesn't have the size really to be a 25 or 30 carry a game back, but he runs like he has a great pad level, stays low. And Sean, he runs through tackles as well as any running back in the country.
They can get a first down at the 1 yard line. 2nd and 3. Benson hit behind the line of scrimmage and dropped for a loss. Again, it was the middle linebacker Doug Justice with help from Will Chapman. Justice already bloodied in this battle with the blood trickling down his nose.
You can see the adjustment early here. North Carolina committing a lot of defenders to the line of scrimmage, and the wide receivers for Chris Sims are there for the taking on the outside, man-to-man coverage.
3rd and 4 from the 5. They spread the field. Brett Robin back in the game. Lined up, offset. Quick drop by Sims. Zings one. Incomplete. Brock Edwards was looking for a flag. Chris Curry had the coverage. And the field goal unit comes on for the Horns. So a fine opening drive stalls at the 5-yard line.
Well, this is just a straight three-step drop, timing route to Edwards. And Chris Curry, really the new face in the secondary for North Carolina, reading the pass, and he made a nice solid break. When you're only working with 5 yards, you have to make a quick break to defend against a tight end down on the goal line.
Dusty Mangum, the sophomore from Mesquite, Texas, attempting a 22-yarder. Chad Stevens, the snapper, and Bo Trahan is the holder, and the kick is up and good. A field goal on the opening drive, and Texas has a 3-0 lead. Texas, as the Longhorns took the opening kickoff from their own 20, went 75 yards before they stalled. 12 plays, 8 of them Cedric Benson runs. They took 5:42 off the clock. Mangum, a 22-yard field goal. And now Richmond McGee, a sophomore from Garland, Texas, will kick off. And a squib kick. He shanked it to the left. There's a flag down. Delay of game. They took too long to kick off. You don't see that very often.
Prior to the kick, delay of game on Texas. Replay the kick.
Cooper Castleberry, the referee, leading a Big 12 officiating crew. These are the officials from Mack Brown's conference, but he's not happy with the familiar faces to this point.
Yeah, usually they'll cut you a little slack in that situation, especially on the opening kickoff the game for Texas. And Mack Brown, as you said, Sean, not real excited.
So McGee will try again. He did intend to squib kick it. I don't think he meant to kick it out of bounds. Kevin Knight and Darrell Mitchell were hoping for a chance to run it back. So it'll be excellent field position for the first offensive possession of the night for North Carolina. Led by the sophomore quarterback from Florence, South Carolina, Darian Durant. Last year he alternated every two series for most of the season with the senior Ronald Curry. He set a number of freshman records at North Carolina, including passing yards and touchdowns in a season. The 40-yard line, the line of scrimmage. As the penalty 30 yards from the spot of the kick. High formation behind Durant. Chesley Borders the motion man. And here's Jock Lewis. One of three tailbacks they'll rotate in over the course of the ball game. A 3-yard gain. Corey Redding made the tackle. The Alamo Rent-A-Car. Starting lineup on offense for North Carolina. Lewis with Hedgecock, who is almost exclusively a blocker. The wide receivers as good as any tandem Texas will face this year, according to Mack Brown, with Aitken and Borders and Hilton, a very good tight end. It is a very young offensive line. There's not a senior among the group, and they've had a major problem with turnovers. And on the center exchange between Brown and Durant, it's caused them a problem in each of their first two games, particularly in the opener against Miami of Ohio, when they tied the school record and conference record with 9 turnovers. Durant's first pass, intended for Chesley Borders, knocked down by Rod Babers, and the partisans in Carolina blue thought Babers made early contact.
Now Darian Durant missed an opportunity here. Watch number 5 on the left side of your screen just leak out into the flat. That's Jaworski Polak. And all Durant has to do is just drop that ball out in the flat. He has a first down and maybe more.
Third down and 7. Durant was responsible for 6 of those 9 turnovers against Miami of Ohio in their upset loss 2 weeks ago. 3 fumbles, 3 interceptions. Over the middle, juggled and dropped. Jaworski Polak had the ball, hit him right off the number 5, and it would have been a first down in Texas territory. Michael Huff, the safety, had the coverage. Here's the Texas defense. Corey Redding, the best defensive end of the country according to both coaches. Tubbs, McKay, and Senline the other starters up front. All new starting linebackers this year, Jackson, Boyd, and Johnson. And a brilliant secondary with Babers and Vasher, perhaps the best corner tandem in the country. Huff and Pearson are the safeties. John Lafferty is the punter. Junior, former walk-on, now on scholarship, his second year as their punter. There's a flag down, likely for a halo violation. Nathan Vasher was back for the punt. The ball down inside the 15, but likely a halo violation against Carolina, which has been upgraded to a 10-yard penalty this year, up from 5. It's a stiffer penalty. Kevin Knight was the player who seemed to violate the space.
Yeah, and I think the rules committee was a couple decades late in changing that rule, Sean. And one of the main reasons that rule was changed a year ago is some pretty aggressive or over-aggressive play by the Fresno State.
Non-contact kick catch interference.
On the West Coast.
On North Carolina. From the spot of the foul. First down.
I think the Carolina coaches are protesting that Knight was blocked into the halo, and therefore there should not have been a flag. 3-0 Texas. We'll return to Chapel Hill in a moment. ABC Sports presentation of college football is brought to you by Chevy Trucks, the most dependable, longest lasting trucks on the road. By Sprint, introducing PCS Vision, clearly a whole new way to look at wireless. By Alamo, the official rent-a-car of the American vacation. And by Valvoline's Max Life, the first motor oil formulated for higher mileage engines. Sean McDonough, David Norrie at sold out Keenan Stadium in Chapel Hill on a very muggy night with a tropical storm in the neighborhood. First and 10, Texas from the 29. Benson stacked up for a loss. The surge led by Chase Page. The sophomore was an offensive lineman last season. Just moved over to defense this year. Critics are calling it stylish, provocative, mysterious, and daring. Don't miss the world premiere of television's hottest new drama, Push Nevada. Catch a special preview Tuesday at 9, that's 8 Central, only on ABC. The creation of Ben Affleck and Sean Bailey. And that show is getting a tremendous amount of positive buzz. As we like to say in the entertainment business, David, you being an L.A. guy could appreciate that. Out in the flat, Benson spins away from Waddell and goes down at the 37-yard line. 2 yards short of a first down. Will Chapman brought him down. This Carolina defense early, David, just missing on a couple of key plays. They couldn't tackle on the big screen pass on the first drive. They had a chance to get Benson, but Waddell missed him.
Yeah, they're selling out to stop the run. Sims going with a controlled passing game. And how about the spin move from Cedric Benson? I mean, this kid has such a great feel at the tailback position and was not real happy after the North Texas game. Only 49 yards on the ground. And on that opening scoring drive, 41 yards for Texas from Benson at the tailback spot.
As a team, they had 28 yards rushing because you had to deduct all the lost yardage from 8 sacks. Sims has a man wide open. Brock Edwards, the tight end, shoved out of bounds near the 35-yard line by Malcolm Stewart. On a couple of key third downs here in the first quarter, big plays. A 42-yard screen on the opening drive, and now a 28-yard completion to the junior from Fort Worth.
Well, we're going to see Edwards right here come all the way across the field. Nice action in the backfield by Sims. A delayed route over the middle. And this team is missing Bo Scaife at tight end. They lost Mike Jones, a pretty seasoned performer from a year ago. Brock Edwards, really the tight end who can still stretch the field. And he was off to the races after Sims dropped the ball off to him.
They thought the loss of Scaife might be huge. He caught 30 balls last year, injured his knee again in the offseason. Sims says there are still plenty of weapons in this arsenal. And he's been moving the ball around effectively here in the first quarter. Timeout, Texas.
Trust me.
And while we were away for the commercial break, the rain has returned to Chapel Hill. And the fans came prepared. They were well aware of the forecast, and most of them, many of them, were out here tailgating in the rain very early this afternoon. First and 10 after the Longhorn timeout. Sims zings one, man open, touchdown, Ivan Williams. One big play after another here in the first quarter. That one's a 35-yarder to the junior from Cleveland, Texas. And it's 9-0 Horns. And
Texas is using play action in the pocket to really sell the run. Beautiful fake by Sims to set up that touchdown pass. And Ivan Williams, a nice job of selling the run as well, and then slipping undetected down the left sideline.
Dusty Mangamont for the extra point. It's the first time Ivan Williams has touched the ball this season. He had no carries or receptions in the opening. He's a former starter at tailback. The extra point good. And Texas has a 10-0 lead with just under 7 minutes remaining in the opening quarter.
Going back to the touchdown, this is Ivan Williams in an offset position, and watch the blast fake to set Williams slipping out into the flat, and a beautifully thrown ball by Sims. I mean, when Sims delivers the ball downfield, it's effortless. The ball just moves off the throwing hand with such ease, and the accuracy of this ball gives the North Carolina secondary absolutely no chance. And the Tar Heels, Sean, coming out in this game early and making some mistakes that you can't make against the number two rated team. I mean, this Texas team will run away and hide early on you if you don't get things together in a hurry.
Darrell Mitchell back for the kickoff along with Kevin Knight and Richmond McGee, who pulled one out of bounds in his first kickoff of the night. We'll try again. This one a much better effort. 3 yards deep. Kevin Knight elects to down it, and Carolina will start at the 20. Sims off to a terrific start. 4 for 5, but no completions yet to the wideouts. He's made use of the players who are open, dumping it off the tight ends and backs very effectively.
Believe me, the wideouts are there if he wants them. North Carolina is getting some safeties involved up to defense the running game, and if Sims wants to take a crack down the field to Johnson or to Williams, it's there for him.
And the sight of the rain can't be welcomed by North Carolina. Here's Jock Lewis turning the corner and picking up a first down at the 34-yard line. Reed Boyd made the tackle. Good pulling block by the guard, Jupiter Wilson. In the opener against Miami of Ohio, they played in a torrential rain throughout the game. It had the 9 turnovers. I'm not sure they want to see rain again after that disaster. The most turnovers committed by a Carolina team since 1933.
No, and for North Carolina to be successful, at least on paper, they're going to have to throw the ball, and they're going to have to throw the ball deep down the field and have some success. Any running yards is going to be gravy for this offensive line.
Lewis trying to run to the other side. Nice cutback. First down and more. Across the 45 to the 46-yard line, Lee Jackson made the tackle, an 11-yard gain for Lewis, the sophomore from Elizabeth City. We spoke with Coach John Bunting and asked him what they had to do to pull off the upset tonight.
On defense, they're extremely, extremely talented. Big, strong, fast. Corey Redding is, I think, the best defensive end I've seen since I've been scouting in the pros for the respective teams I coach for or this past year. That's including Julius. Julius is pretty doggone good. This guy is special, and he can take a game over. So we've got to account for where Corey Redding is all the time.
The officials have stopped the play. John Bunting doesn't know why. The chains got tangled up on the far sideline. That's why. And John doesn't like it. You can understand that. His team had plenty of momentum after a couple of nifty runs by Jock Lewis.
Now, Coach Bunning has to love the fact that this offensive line and this running game has just picked up successive first downs on successive plays. And I said any additional yards that this team can pick up on the ground are going to be gravy. They have not had a lot of success in the running game except for the fourth quarter last week against Syracuse, where this line really came of age.
Looked like they wore Syracuse out coming from behind in the fourth quarter to win 30-22. Lewis again. Some nifty moves through the traffic across midfield to the 49, where he was chopped down by the safety, Dakari Pearson.
And to be fair to it, they got a touchdown run, a 50-yarder from Willie Parker last week, but no consistency until that fourth quarter. And this is great news for North Carolina. The big guys working up front, creating holes. You know, if there's one weakness for Texas in that front seven, you can out-physical this team in the man-to-man matchups.
The pitch to Willie Parker. First down, out of bounds at the Texas 38. He was the man who ran for 50 and a score last week against Syracuse. He's more of a home run threat. The coaches told us there's not much difference between Lewis Parker and the third man, Andre Williams. Lewis is just a little bit better at everything. They like Parker's speed, breakaway skills, but he doesn't often run it up inside hard enough for the coaches like it.
And when you talk to Tar Heels fans, they say Parker loves to play on turf, not as effective a back on grass. But I can recall a game last year against Maryland where he ripped off a 70-yard touchdown run against the Terrapins early in the season.
Lewis went back in and ran into Corey Redding. You heard John Bunting say a moment ago he thinks Redding's even better than Julius Peppers, who played for Carolina last year and was the second pick in the NFL draft.
That's tall praise. And when you talk to offensive coordinators up and down the East Coast and stretching over to Texas, they say this guy is capable of controlling a football game. You've always got to keep track of where he is on the football field and oftentimes use double teams to control.
Out of the shotgun, they spread five receivers to pass on target to Jaworski Polak. And he was tackled quickly by the linebacker Lee Jackson. Jackson's had an injury-plagued career at Texas, now a senior. Has missed 19 games over the previous two seasons due to hamstring, leg, and toe injuries. Back in 99, he was their starter at strong safety and led the team in solo tackles. He's just hoping to stay healthy. Third down, and a timeout needed by the Tar Heels. A little confusion as they were coming up to the line for the third down and seven. Next Saturday, join ABC Sports for another great day of college football. You'll see number 9 Virginia Tech undefeated get into Aggieland to battle number 23 Texas A&M, or other regional action. That's next Saturday at 3:30 Eastern, 12:30 Pacific, right here on ABC Sports, the class of college football. John Bunting and Mack Brown, they don't know each other very well. John Bunting told us during the week he had met Mack Brown a number of times at the ACC basketball tournament. Bunting, as we said at the top of the telecast, about as passionate a Tar Heel as you can be, back to his playing days here in the late 60s. Ever since then, for 30 years plus, wherever he has gone, whether it be in the NFL, playing for the Philadelphia Eagles, coaching jobs at Glassboro State, or assistant posts in the NFL, he has taken with him a picture of Keenan Stadium. For 30 years, the same picture is the first thing that he puts up in his locker or in his new office, and he has brought that picture with him to Chapel Hill. He'd like to picture a first down. Movement along the line. Flags down. Looked like the horns were offside. Durant escapes for the moment. Then throws incomplete along the near sideline. But they might get another chance with the movement right over the ball.
Yeah, this should be offsides. They don't let the play go if it's a penalty against the offensive front for North Carolina. So they'll replay play the down. And the Tar Heels will pick up 5.
That'll turn it into third down and 2. Here's a look at that picture from Keenan Stadium that has followed John Bunting along his trail. He coached 5 years as the head man at Division III Glassboro State, had tremendous success there. Now it's Rowan University, and they still have a fine Division III program. Went on to the assistant ranks in the NFL for 8 years before he was hired 2 years ago. Lost his first three last year, then won 8 out of 10, including a Peach Bowl victory over Auburn. And the upset went along the way against Florida State.
Looked a little too studious in his office there to be a linebacker.
Third and two, a nice hole and a first down. Jock Lewis had plenty of room and found that opening. It took the secondary, Griffin, Pearson, and Babers all to bring him down.
Now you talk about a team responding. The Tar Heels fall down by 2 touchdowns. It starts to rain, and they go to the ground game. And Jock Lewis, as we said, the best complete back, not afraid to run in between the tackles. And this offensive line is starting to move the Texas defensive front around.
After the 6 yard gain and a first down, Lewis planted up top by Redding after Dakari Pearson got him around the ankles. Redding said, hello.
One of the luxuries that Texas has to stop a running game, the great cornerback play on the outside. The Babers and Vasher, they can lock up man to man and bring a safety or two up close to the line of scrimmage.
Carolina doing it on the ground. Willie Parker back in at running back. Takes the swing pass. He's in trouble. And dropped for a loss. They jumped on the pile as if the ball came out. And if it did, the Heels got it back. Rod Babers, the corner, held his ground. Parker appeared to get the ball back. A loss of a yard on the play. Corey Redding, a big playmaker. He made a huge one in the ball game between these two teams last year in Austin. An interception. Dropped back into the flat, returned it 22 yards. How about that athleticism?
Wow.
They scored 30 unanswered points in that game to win 44-14. And another timeout. I believe Texas called that one. It is starting to rain hard, as you can tell. Either that or they gave Mac Brown a very premature Gatorade shower.
Yeah, it looks like they had some substitution problems, and Mac Brown wants to get the right athletes out on the field. John Bunny wants this drive to stay alive.
It was a Texas timeout. Michael Schumacher is the first Formula One driver to win 10 races in a single season. Tomorrow, he tries to put a Ferrari in victory lane for a record 15th time at the Italian Grand Prix. That's tomorrow at 1 Eastern, 3 Pacific on ABC. He's trying to win the Grand Prix of Italy for the 4th time in the last 7 years.
Now, pro scouts in the NFL ranks, they look at Corey Redding and they see a kid who can run a sub 4.8 at that defensive end position and going about 280 pounds with the athletic ability that he has. Now, he's a lock for a top 10 pick in the NFL draft.
Big part of that highly touted recruiting class of 1999. Sims, the National Offensive Player of the Year, and Redding, the Defensive High School Player of the Year. Durant in trouble, sacked from behind. Ball pops out. Lee Jackson with the sack. And they're going to rule Durant down by contact. And the ground caused the fumble. An 8 yard loss.
Well, Texas is going to bring number 8 Cedric Griffin on a blitz, and he frees things up for Lee Jackson on the backside. Darian Durant trying to avoid the defensive back on the blitz, and as a result he frees up Lee Jackson.
Now Dan Orner trying a 49 yard field goal. He made 3 field goals of more than 50 yards last week at Syracuse, indoors in perfect conditions. This one off the right upright. That had plenty of leg, but it clanged off the right upright. His first miss. He set the NCAA record, tied it with 3 field goals of 50 or more last week at Syracuse, and he nearly had a 49 yarder to add.
Yeah, and it really was the best debut in the history of college football from the place kicking spot. That was his first game.
Just missed that one.
Just misses. And look at Mac Brown as the ball glances off that right upright.
Warner had never attempted a field goal in college until last week. He didn't have any attempts in the opener against Miami of Ohio. He tied the NCAA record by Jerry DePoister of Wyoming in 1966. Sergio Lopez Chavero of Wichita State in 84 and Tim Douglas of Iowa in 1998. Cedric Benson ahead for 3 yards on first down. And they passed up David in the third quarter. Down by six. An opportunity to have Warner try a 55-yard field goal, or he might have made four.
The way he was going, I'm pretty certain he would have hit it. I mean, he made those three kicks look easy, and they really needed number 10 to come up with a victory up at Syracuse. You don't walk into Syracuse and come away with a victory very easy.
He wasn't a lock to be their kicker until very late in the preseason. Carolina was offside, a free play for Texas, and Sims wants the deep ball. And it's incomplete. Intended for Roy Williams with Dexter Reed, the safety in coverage. But it's likely an offside infraction against the Tar Heels.
We look at the end of this play and watch the catch that Roy Williams almost comes up with. And that's a reverse basket catch.
He was out of bounds.
That wouldn't have been good, but Chris Sims has an ability that his father had at the line of scrimmage, very adept at drawing defensive players into the neutral zone with his cadence, and he'll do it time and again if he's having success.
Replay second down.
So another down and distance that a lot of coaches think is a free play, second down and one. Well, I remember when I was at Syracuse, David, the great coach Dick McPherson almost always used to run it straight ahead on second and one, and people would ask him why, and he said, "I like first downs." And that's what the Horns are trying to do, just pick up the first down, running more or less straight ahead with Cedric Benson. And he moves the chains with a 3 yard gain to the 45. Carl Smalls made the tackle.
Well, Dick McPherson isn't alone. You know, there's a lot of coaches that love first downs. And look at the big offensive line for Texas working in the pits. And they have to love a tailback like Benson working behind him, because Benson is a lot like Emmitt Smith. He can work through tight spaces, breaks tackles, and makes you look very good as an offensive front.
He set the Texas freshman rushing record last year, 1,053 yards, more than even the great Earl Campbell and Ricky Williams. Sims sidestepped the rush, throws, what a play by Sims. First down to B.J. Johnson. A gain to the Carolina 33. Malcolm Stewart came on a blitz. Sims sidestepped him with ease, a 22-yard gain, and there's a new school record. Johnson had been tied for consecutive games with a catch, 26 with Michael Adams, and now has the record of 27 all to himself.
This is a great play, resetting in the pocket. Malcolm Stewart coming on the blitz, number 85, the linebacker, and Sims moves, slips the tackle, and delivers an NFL-type ball to the outside to Johnson.
First completion to a wideout, 135 yards for Sims here in the first quarter. Back to the run with Benson. He's to the 29-yard line on what will be the last play of the first quarter. ABC Sports presentation of college football will return after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
You're watching college football on ABC Sports Championship Television.
Texas built a 10-0 lead in the first quarter through the air and on the ground. Sims has thrown for 134. Benson has rushed for 54. 19 snaps in the first quarter for the Texas offense. 12 rushes by Benson. Second and five from the Carolina 29 on the opening play of the second quarter. Benson through the line of scrimmage. And he has a first down at the 20. 13th carry already for Benson. Jaquish Dumas, the backup defensive end, made the play. John Bunting said we'll rotate a lot of people in up front, probably 9 different defensive linemen will see action in this game.
This is when it gets fun for an offensive coordinator, and Greg Davis, the O coordinator for the Texas Longhorns getting a great mix of run and pass. And when you get that running game started, it gives you so many options in your playbook.
First and 10 from the 20. Benson again, the burst of speed as he took the handoff and showing his power as well. He took Doug Justice for a ride and a late flag thrown. There was some pushing and shoving at the end of that play. Play came to an end very near first down yardage. Officials having a tough time sorting it out.
Yeah, you can tell by the reaction from the Texas players that this is going to be one of those halfway to the goal line. Ring up a first down potentially.
To the play a foul on North Carolina. Personal foul Texas. Those people cancel.
There's Greg Davis, the offensive coordinator. Under his direction, they've been setting all kinds of Texas offensive records in recent years. In each of Mack Brown's seasons here at Texas, they've had a 2,000-yard passer, a 1,000-yard rusher, and a 100-point scorer. Gain of 9+. Second in inches for the Horns from just outside the 10. Benson rumbling down to the 3-yard line, and Chris Curry was able to hang on for the ride and take him down, or that was going to be another touchdown for Texas.
Now we talked about Greg Davis, and he's doing some things with formations to take away the 8-man front for North Carolina, going with two tight ends. And Cedric Benson, I mean, he is so good at making the first defender that shows miss and then running through tackles, and a great combination of quickness and power. Pretty special back down on the goal line as well.
Davis compares him to Emmett Smith. Not real flashy, but he makes you miss and he scores touchdowns. Touchdown Benson from 4 yards out. And number 2 Texas looking very much like the number 2 team of the nation. Up 16-0 early in the second quarter. Dusty Mangum on for the extra point. Benson with 83 yards rushing. Just more than 16 minutes into the game. The extra point good. 17-0 Longhorns in Chapel Hill.
You lollygag the ball around the infield. You lollygag your way down to first. You lollygag in and out of the dugout. Do you know what that makes you? Larry?
Lollygaggers.
Lollygaggers. What's our record, Larry?
8-16.
8-16. How do we ever win 8?
It's a miracle.
It's a miracle.
Baseball Tonight, every night at 10 and midnight on ESPN.
Cedric Benson, 16 carries, 83 yards, and a touchdown. Texas, which scored on 5 of its first 6 possessions in the opener against North Texas, has scored on all 3 possessions tonight. Richmond McGee's kickoff down to the true freshman, Darrell Mitchell, and he's down at the 22-yard line. Garnett Smith made the tackle. Time now for the Pacific Life game summary. Chris Sims on target early, the first touchdown for Texas, a 35-yard pass to Ivan Williams. And then the most recent touchdown, the 4-yard run by Benson. Darian Durant, 2 for 4, but for just 1 yard passing. They break the huddle with just one back behind him, Jock Lewis. Durant with time, his pass batted down by Austin Senline, sophomore from Scottsdale, Arizona.
Well, tonight's Chrysler passing playbook, Sean. If Darian Durant can smell man-to-man coverage and a blitz on the line of scrimmage, he can take a shot down the field to Sam Akin, a split end. And what they like to do in this situation is they like to go with play action. A blast action on the left side, Sam Akin at the split end position. Nice mesh between quarterback, the fake, and then over the top, taking the shot in the man-to-man defense.
Nothing doing on second and 10. Miguel McKay led the defensive surge on Jock Lewis. With help from Boston Senline, McKay is a senior. They didn't really know what they were getting at him last week. 2 weeks ago in the opener against North Texas, he was a journeyman in the program. Really came out of nowhere in the spring to earn a spot, in part because he got over a sleep disorder that he had. It caused him great difficulty in sleeping. They diagnosed it, they've been treating it, and as a result, he has much more energy and strength on the football field. Whistle stopped the play. Near the third down and 10 upcoming.
Timeout.
Well, Texas.
Final timeout.
Has now burned all of its timeouts. It's about the only negative so far for Mac Brown. They're expecting a record crowd of more than 60,000 here at Keenan Stadium, where the Heels have been playing football since 1927. Sean McDonough, David Norrie, watching number 2 Texas open up a 17-0 lead over the Tar Heels, who could really use a conversion on this third down and 10 from their own 22. Durant out of the shotgun. The horns rush 4. Durant throws off his back foot, and it is almost intercepted by Dakari Pearson. Intended for Sam Akin. But Durant more or less threw that one up for grabs. Let's throw it to John Saunders at Times Square Stadium.
Sean, time for the Burger King update. Nebraska facing Penn State, and the Nittany Lions already up 7-0. Judd Davis, though, goes in from 2 yards out to tie this game at 7 apiece. 108,000 people on hand to watch this one, Sean.
That makes our record crowd of 60,000 plus seem
a little paltry.
A little paltry by comparison. Call up a few of your friends and get them over here. See if we can catch up. John Lafferty, a booming punt to Nathan Vasher, one of the best punt return men in the nation. Chris Hawkins with a terrific tackle. Vasher almost single-handedly changed the game between these two teams in Austin last year. He had a punt return for a touchdown and two other very long returns. ABC Sports presentation of college football is brought to you by Chrysler. Drive equals love. By Bowflex for real fitness results. And by Bud Light for the great taste that won't fill you up and never let you down. Make it a Bud Light. That's a fitting set of billboards for us. Myself a Bowflex man, you a Bud Light man.
Oh, for post game at least.
I'm the body double in those Bowflex commercials. I don't know if you knew that. First and 10. Sims comes out throwing and throwing deep. And it is broken up, but a nice defensive play by Kevin Knight. B.J. Johnson with outstanding speed. Appeared to have a step for a moment, but Knight close the ground.
This is a nice ball, but even better coverage by Knight. Knight was a nickelback a year ago. He moves up after Errol Hood graduates. We're talking to Chris Sims yesterday. He said B.J. Johnson really is a smooth, deep route runner, and he gets a lot of momentum, acceleration down the field. And look at Knight get a hand in between. That's a beautiful play by a cornerback.
Second and 10. Just the second incompletion thrown by Sims. Draw play. Benson pulled down at the 41. Appears to be about a yard short of the first down. Clarence Gaddy a backup linebacker, made the tackle. Benson rapidly approaching 100 yards. He's up to 92. Nothing but scores so far. They drove to the 5-yard line and kicked the field goal on the opening drive, and 2 touchdowns since.
That's the biggest nightmare for a defensive coach, to watch the opposing team control the ball on the ground. And that's what's going on right now. John Bunning has to be very concerned, down 17-0.
They haven't stopped them yet. 3rd and 1. Extra man up around the line. Sims going deep. He had the tight end Brock Edwards open, but airmailed him. Chris was under duress. Chris Curry had the coverage, but Edwards had a couple of steps behind the safety man.
Yeah, you look from a high angle, and Sims is going to go ahead and take a shot down the field, but he finds his tight end late. And I don't like to make a lot of excuses for tight ends, or actually quarterbacks. The ball's a little bit slick, some rain down on the field, and if Sims picks up his tight end a little earlier on that play, I think he gets off a better ball, Sean.
Being a former UCLA quarterback, you do and have many times over the years make excuses for quarterbacks. Chris told us yesterday he has big hands. The rain doesn't really bother him. He just tries to grip the ball a bit more lightly so it doesn't squirt out of his hands. Ryan Bradford's punt returned by Michael Waddell. A 43-yard punt, a 12-yard return. The snapper, Colin Leffler, ran down to bang Waddell out of bounds. Monday night, a terrific matchup. New coach Steve Spurrier makes his Monday Night Football debut. He's always great theater. Al Michaels and John Madden will be in Washington. There's the revamped Redskins take on Donovan McNabb and the Eagles. That's Monday night at 9 on ABC.
I was talking to my old head coach, now the general manager for the 49ers, Sean, and a former partner of yours, Terry Donahue, and he said what's so great about Spurrier, he calls plays without fear. And it's a tough assignment as a defensive coordinator going up against that guy.
Corey Redding wreaking havoc again on Andre Williams, the 3rd different tailback to carry the ball now for Carolina. He was their leading rusher last year, but has had back problems, had surgery, and now 3rd string.
How about the speed off the edge by number 40? And it's North Carolina. You're down 10-0. You could show some patience. Now 17 zip. And you got to start leaning a little more heavily on the passing game.
Durant, who patterns himself after Donovan McNabb, will be watching his idol Monday night. He scrambled out to the 35, picked up 5. They'll need 7 more for a 1st down. Here's one of my idols, John Saunders at Times Square Stadium.
Mutual, but for Florida, looks like they're idolizing the run right now. Rand Carthon gets it in from 5 yards out, still just 21-6 over Ohio.
That's an Ohio team that lost at home to Northeastern University 31-0 last week.
Nowhere to go but up off that performance.
Third down and 7. Texas with a 17-0 lead, 10 minutes left in the half. Durant dumps it off short. It's incomplete. Wasn't going to be anywhere near a 1st down anyway for Jaworski Polak. Derek Johnson is right there in coverage.
And this Texas defensive unit very tough in obvious passing situations because of their ability to turn loose the speed. They get the corners locking up a man-to-man on the outside, and then they blitz you as a quarterback. And I think North Carolina and Darian Durant are going to have more success getting back in this game if they throw in obvious run situations, give him some time and give him some freedom for the wide receivers to get open on the outside.
Lafferty, a high short punt, and bounces sideways out of bounds to the 36, a 31-yard punt. But the good news is no punt return by Vasher. Last year against North Carolina, Nathan returned 8 punts for 153 yards. That's a 19.1 yard average, including a 44-yard touchdown. He returns a 59 and 31 among the 8. The touchdown was the 1st punt return for a touchdown at Texas in 99 games, dating back to Mike Adams against Syracuse, a 54-yard return in 1993.
His lightning quickness, and of course a starter as a safety last year. He moves up into that slot vacated by Quentin Jammer, a 1st round pick. North Carolina was in that game. It was a 20-14 score at half, and Vasher took over.
And both sides, we spoke with during the week, admitted that the punt returns really changed the whole complexion of the game. Chad Stevens, the tight end, tackled immediately by Kevin Knight. A gain of one. It'll be second down and 9 for Texas. On the ground with Benson. Nice blocking on the left side. They certainly have fixed some of their offensive line problems that plagued them 2 weeks ago. Dexter Reed and Derek Johnson combined on the stop, but not until Benson had run for 17 more. And he's over 100 now with 109 yards rushing.
Great work inside here, particularly number 61, Tillman Holloway. I mean, they are just gashing holes in this front four for North Carolina. And you go back a year ago, Sean, one of the best front fours in the country. Peppers, Ryan Sims, a couple top 5 picks.
And they did a great job on Peppers last year, particularly Robbie Doan, the left tackle. Peppers did not have a tackle in the game last year for North Carolina. Sims, great job avoiding the rush, dumped it off short. Chris has been impressive tonight in taking that one little step to dodge a rusher. Malcolm Stewart coming on a blitz.
Taking a look at the protection of this offensive line, and once again Stewart coming on the blitz. A little too much speed off the edge for Robbie Doan to get outside, and that forced a quick throw by Sims.
You mentioned Tillman Holloway. He's from a great Texas family. Both parents, all 4 grandparents, attended UT. His grandfather Bud McFadden, a 2-time All-American at Texas in the late 40s. He's in the College Football Hall of Fame. What a thrill for Tillman to be a starting offensive lineman. Wrestled down was Benson on a nice tackle by Tommy Davis, the redshirt freshman from Dudley, North Carolina. He was a linebacker during his redshirt freshman season in practice and moved to defensive end in the spring. The coaches, particularly Dave Huxtable, the defensive coordinator with whom we spoke during the week, think he's going to be a great player in the future.
Cedric Benson getting the blow on the sideline. And you know, you look at number 32, you look at the numbers today, Sean, already gone over the 100-yard mark. He reminds me a little bit of Marcus Allen, the way he's always falling forward at the end of the play, picking up extra yards.
Empty backfield. 5 receivers spread the formation on 3rd down and 7 from the Carolina 44. The heels blitz. Sims has a man caught by Roy Williams, and a touchdown saving tackle made by Michael Waddell. 35 yards on the hookup, and Sims is on top of his game tonight. Made a great decision throwing it to Williams.
Only a matter of time. Williams slips out of the slot position, and for the first time in Texas, maybe he is 100% healthy. Had some bone chips removed from the ankle. It's made him that much more lethal. And along with Charles Rogers and Reggie Williams up at the University of Washington, I think those 3 are the premier receivers in the country that can dominate a football game. Sims off to a pretty good start.
Benson doing some nifty maneuvering but couldn't get away. Just too many Carolina blue shirts led by Doug Justice. Texas has already had 5 offensive plays of 20 yards or longer just midway through the second quarter.
And Sims has been brilliant at the line of scrimmage. He does so much work at the line of scrimmage getting this team to the downhill running plays. And what I mean by downhill running plays is for Mac Brown, he'll give a check at the line of scrimmage and get his offensive lineman good blocking angles. And he also can check to the deep ball on the outside, as we saw a couple plays ago to Roy Williams.
From the 9, 2nd and goal, Benson seemed to have a hole, but Justice banged him down very quickly at the 6. Let's check in again with John at Times Square Stadium.
Well, Florida State continues their year-to-year domination of the Maryland Terrapins. Chris Ricks back to pass and launches this one. Gardner hauls it in, and then just has to walk into the end zone. 30-0 is the score. It's still in the first half. Penn State has just added a field goal to move ahead of Nebraska 10-7. Sean.
Thank you, John. Here in Chapel Hill, third down and goal from just outside the six. Brett Robin on the field. Here comes the blitz. Sims lofts up the fade. Roy Williams. Touchdown. Chris Sims, brilliant here in the first half. He hung in there knowing the blitz was coming and threw the fade ball perfectly to Roy Williams.
And that's a fade ball against one of the best cover corners in the country in Waddell. Great footwork, three-step drop, get the ball to the corner quickly. A little top on the ball, a little air. And Roy Williams slow plays Waddell, doesn't let him know the ball's going to arrive until the last second with his eyes. Makes a nice catch in the corner of the end zone.
While being held by the back of his jersey, Dusty Mangum boots the extra point. Roy Williams, the junior from Odessa, Texas. The touchdown and extra point make it 24-0. These are Roy Williams, number 5 in career receptions at the University of Texas already, with 114, now 16 career touchdown receptions. And they're expecting bigger and better things from him this season. He was plagued by bone chips in his ankle all of last year. Had them removed in the offseason. Chris Sims told us yesterday Williams is noticeably better, more spring in his legs, and better to run those curls and comebacks so he can drive off the ankle as he comes back toward the line of scrimmage.
Absolutely. And when you have the deep speed to threaten defensive backs that way, it makes things very easy for a quarterback to hit those comebacks and those curls. You get a lot of separation in between wide receiver and cornerback.
Well, the only big negative so far for Mack Brown in his return to Chapel Hill, Richmond McGee has had a couple of low duck hooks out of bounds on kickoffs. The total yardage is 282 to 49. That'll be a math formula for you. Figure out how many plays they've run. I'll leave it to the UCLA guy.
Trying to confuse me again, aren't you, Sean?
From the 35, first and 10. Jaworski Polak looking for a block from Durant. He gets the block, but he's still in big trouble and dropped for a big loss. Simply too much speed on this defense to get away with that. Derek Johnson, about as fast an outside linebacker as you'll see, ran it down for a loss of 7.
Trailing by more than 3 touchdowns, North Carolina is going to have to give up on the run game a little bit here. And I think Darian Durant's going to have a lot more success throwing the ball down the football field and not coming underneath on the short passing game. He's got to take a few shots to loosen up this Texas defense and maybe hit a big play.
The Texas coaches, defensive coordinator Carl Reese, told us he was expecting about 15 deep balls. It's one of the strengths of Durant. Forced to throw it short. Jock Lewis broke a tackle, breaks another, and might have a first down. Didn't quite get there. They'll mark him out just beyond the 44, about a half yard short of the first down. O.J. McClintock finally made the tackle. Here's John Saunders at Times Square Stadium.
Well, Miami of Ohio stuck around long enough, but Florida says let's put it away. Rex Grossman tossed there. Ernest Graham breaks the tackle. From there, it's open field sailing. He isn't touched again until he's already across the line. 28-6 now, the Gators up.
Heck of a pitch play there by Grossman, getting on the outside and dishing the card off the bottom of the deck.
On third and 1, the Tar Heels convert as Jock Lewis carried to the 47. Marcus Tubbs made the tackle. John Bunting, 52 years old. Terrific linebacker for the Eagles for 11 years. Played for Dick Vermeil. And he is about as intense as any head coach that you'll talk to. He talks about changing the attitude of this program. He's quite intolerant of any kind of misbehavior on the field, off the field, in the classroom. And in this day and age, I say good for him. He's tossed a number of players out of this program who were good players as part of his violation of 3 strikes policy. There's a deep down the field throw by Durant, and Sam Aiken makes the catch. 27 yard gain for Aiken, the senior from Kenansville, North Carolina.
And this is what we've been looking for. He's going to work against Huff. And we talked about the best three receivers in the country. Aiken is right up there with the best of them in the NCAA. This kid has size, he has sneaky speed down the field, and great ball skills. And the key on that play, the ball got there in a hurry and it got to the spot. Beautiful throw by Durant.
First catch for Aiken. He had 13 total in the first two games. Inside handoff, Willie Parker. Dragged down by Reed Boyd. But again inside the 25 to the 23.
We talked about all the exchange problems that the Tar Heels have had in the first two games, and nice play by Durant there in the shotgun. Low snap and still deals the ball off to his tailback.
Second and six. Obviously, North Carolina in dire need of a score on this drive. Durant throws it into double coverage, intercepted. Terrible decision by Durant. And Dakari Pearson picked it off in the end zone.
Durant got a little greedy on this one. And he lost track of the safety. Number nine, Dakari Pearson, has a lot of depth in the end zone. Durant thought he had man-to-man coverage on the outside. Threw the ball outside. This might have been a misfire from Durant. And Pearson comes all the way, reads his eyes. The pressure playing into it. And not a smart ball. The Tar Heels, Sean, needed that drive big time to get back in this game, to maintain some touch. And a big mistake from number four.
Fourth career interception for Pearson. And the Longhorns will take over at their own 20, leading 24-0. Some pushing and shoving after that last interception. That might be what the officials are talking to John Bunting about. No flag on the play. Ball out to the 20. First and 10 Longhorns. 4 minutes left in the half. They lead 24-0. Tony Jeffrey, the motion man, took the handoff. And the wide receiver is out to the 28-yard line. He's a former quarterback in high school. That Klein Forrest in the Houston area. And Greg Davis, the offensive coordinator, told us during the week, this is really the first time, Tony's a sophomore now, that he thinks Jeffrey is totally comfortable at wide receiver.
He's known as a pretty good route runner. Sims has become comfortable with him. And getting back to the issue of this game, Sean, you margin of error is so small, and you just can't play against a Texas team like this, make errors, not finish off drives, and expect to be in the ball game even at halftime.
Benson trying to run over Derek Johnson. Flag down on the play, thrown at the line of scrimmage. Play stands. It's a first down, but it was thrown right in the middle of the offensive line. Horns are clapping. I don't know why. It's against them. Coming up on the Valvoline Halftime Show, John Saunders and Terry Bowden will bring you all the scores and highlights from around college football today.
Mac Brown visibly distraught after that penalty. You know, head coaches like Mac Brown, and we talked at the top about how his team figures into the BCS race and really one of the three or four favorites to be in that Fiesta Bowl game for the national championship. He likes to see his team finish other teams off and go for the jugular, and penalties like that last one keep the Tar Heels in it longer.
Rain has been off and on. It's a steady light rain right now on second and 11. Sims going deep, and it is dropped by B.J. Johnson. The drop balls were a problem in the opener against North Texas. Greg Davis said he counted, watching the film, four drops. And that one was a perfectly thrown ball by Sims, and it might have gone for a touchdown.
Another beautiful throw from Chris Sims. And Knight mistimes his jump right here. B.J. Johnson has to make that play. If he makes that play, he's got a chance with his running ability to score after the catch. And just a great shot down the field. We look at Greg Davis. His young quarterback takes a great shot and another beautiful ball on a post corner route.
Third down and 11. Plenty of time for Sims. He zips one too high. One of the few poor throws tonight by Sims. Roy Williams went up in the air but couldn't get it. And Texas will punt for just the second time in the half.
Was one of the rare mistakes throwing the ball that we've seen from Sims tonight. And sometimes when you have a talented throwing arm and you've got a lot of arm strength, you don't throw the ball on time. And Sims, if he throws that ball on time and in rhythm to the outside on the out route, he hits it.
Brian Bradford, the senior from Lufkin, Texas. Punting it away to Michael Waddell. He caught it on the move at the 37. Made the first man miss. And he got knocked out of bounds at the 47. A 10-yard return of a 44-yard punt. Next weekend, Tiger Woods heads a field that includes British Open champion Ernie Els, Sergio Garcia, and Phil Mickelson. World Golf Championships, American Express Championship. ABC's coverage begins next Saturday at 1 Eastern. Final round coverage next Sunday at 1:30 Eastern, 12:30 Pacific. Time for North Carolina and Darian Durant to get something done. He hasn't done much yet. Just 44 yards passing and a very costly interception in the end zone. And they had a nice drive going. He's in trouble and sacked. Kalen Thornton was there, but Marcus Tubbs was the primary man in the sack. And a loss back inside the 40-yard line.
Taking a look at the Texas defense with the speed and attacking the pocket with the cornerbacks on the outside locking up in man-to-man. They've been a difference along with the offensive line and the running game for Texas, as well as Sims passing and making things real tough on Durant.
Well, another bad throw by Durant. Babers saw that one coming but dropped it. That's been a recurring theme throughout Babers' career. He's a great cover corner but just can't hang on to the ball. His teammates have nicknamed him Stone Hands, and Babers said last year, one of my favorite quotes over the years of doing this, David, he said, "I have a motto. Nobody catches the ball on my side of the field, not even me."
you gotta love that positive attitude by Babers. And Babers saw so much activity last year. Teams would not go after Quentin Jammer on the opposite side, and Babers held up. This is another kid on this Texas defensive unit who could be a first rounder in the NFL draft.
Just a three-man rush and almost an interception again by Michael Huff. He was looking to take it to the house. They know exactly where Durant is going with every throw.
And Durant got off to a bad start on that drive, and this was a drive that the Tar Heels needed. And taking the sack on first down put his team in a hole. And that was really the mistake. And very, very lucky for Darian that this game isn't 31-0. John Bunny knows it.
Lafferty punts it to Vasher. He got past the first two men. And a nice return back out to the 38-yard line. Jock Lewis, starting running back, covering that punt and making the tackle. Don't miss a special preview of the show all the critics are raving about. Push Nevada. Tuesday at 9. I don't know about all. I cannot say that I've read every preview of this show, but all the ones that I've read include words like stylish, provocative, mysterious, and daring, and those are just a few that are on the promo card.
Ben Affleck taking a little foray into the world of production, branching out.
Ben and Matt Damon involved in a production company, Live Planet.
I can just get my fiance to stop talking about Ben.
Let's see if they go for the jugular with a 24-0 lead. Excellent field position. No timeouts, however, for Texas. Quick throw and a drop by Roy Williams. It's contagious.
Now Roy Williams had visions of breakaway.
Dexter Reed, really the defensive leader for the Tar Heels. This entire defensive structure runs through Reed. They use him to blitz. Got a route welcoming from Derek Dockery, big offensive tackle. But Reed is really one of the top safeties in the country. And he's the guy that the Tar Heels like to get involved up near the line of scrimmage against the run.
That is incomplete, almost a lateral. Little trickery there as Sims had to spin all the way around. But his throw was low to Williams, so they're getting a little bit out of sync here. Reminiscent of the first game when they got off to a very fast start against North Texas and then seemed to lose their focus.
And Sims has been great in the first half, making all the right decisions, knowing where to go with the football, and he's made some big time throws as well. We talked, Sean, yesterday about what quarterbacks in the country would you rather have than Chris Sims, and I can't come up with a lot of them. I think he's that impressive.
Rush well picked up, the throw incomplete. Sims fired a laser beam for Edwards, the tight end, but Chris Curry had tight coverage that time.
Edwards right down the middle of the field, and Curry the strong safety with some impressive coverage here, because this is another nice ball from Sims. That ball is right on the money, and actually Edwards should make that catch. That's a drop. Curry just late
drop balls are starting to add up. Waddell back for the Brian Bradford punt. Sociology major with a line drive kick. It lands on the sideline at the 25. Now the 26. 36 yard punt and no return. 1:18 left in the half. Two timeouts left for North Carolina. You think down by this much, David, they have to try to attack here and get something on the board before the break.
A minute 18 is plenty of time in college football to get a touchdown, especially when you have a couple timeouts left. And it's as long as a quarterback as you keep the ball beyond the chains. If you throw the ball beyond the chains, don't take sacks, you can keep that clock stopped. And this is a critical drive. If they could come up with a score here against Texas, it becomes a ball game at halftime.
Big throw one way, the screen the other. Willie Parker shakes and bakes his way out to the 37-yard line. Good for a first down. A gain of 11. Nathan Vasher made the tackle, and he'll go without a huddle.
Get up to the line of scrimmage here. No need to throw the ball in turf. This clock stays stopped until the referee whistles it ready for play. You get your offensive team up to the line of scrimmage, and you snap the ball, run one of your favorite passing plays.
Out of the shotgun. Just a four-man rush. Good throw by Durant. Sam Aiken. First down into Texas territory at the 44-yard line. 26 yards on the completion. Pearson made the tackle. Second catch for Aiken. A wonderful young man in addition to being a terrific football player. Lives at home 30 minutes away from the campus to help his mom raise his younger brothers and sisters. Here's a blitz. Durant rolled away. Running room for Parker. First down inside the 30. And down to the 26. Again, they will stop the clock to move the chains.
This is an improvement, Sean. Last week when they picked up first downs on a clock drive late in the second quarter against Syracuse. I mean, look, there's a flag on the field here.
In the secondary, deep down the field at the 12-yard line. I don't think the referee, Cooper Castleberry, knows there's a flag. None of his colleagues are running toward him. Now here they come.
Tar Heels, as I mentioned against Syracuse last week, would throw the ball to the ground to stop the clock after first down.
Wonder if they had too many men on the field. Illegal participation.
If they lined up with 12 and didn't make an attempt to get off the field with an individual player, that's a 15-yarder.
12 on Texas. Penalty is reduced. First down.
A taking a look. I'm not sure if we can count them all here on the line of scrimmage, but still a great play by Darian Durant to escape the rush. Great feet. And then drop it off to your experienced tailback.
Wagner was blocking and then helped his quarterback. Now becoming a receiver. And just inside the 28. Jock Lewis back in, lineup offset. Here's the rush. Here's Durant. Not a speed burner, runs a 4.8 40, but fast enough. Inside the 5, touchdown! Yards on the run, and Jock Lewis injured on the play. He's down at the 14-yard line. The Tar Heels on the board with 17 seconds left in the half.
What a drive, and what a performance by Durant. He makes a mistake on the last possession. Looks like his team's going to go into the locker room down by more than 3 touchdowns, and beautifully engineered drive by Durant. Let's freeze it when he gets in the pocket. Look at the opening right here, the seam, and he'll go ahead and take it. And his runs were a big part of putting that game away against Syracuse last week on the final drive.
Lewis might have just had the wind knocked out of him as he got up and ran off very briskly. First rushing touchdown of the season for Darian Durant. And the longest career rush for the North Carolina quarterback. Dan Orner, a transfer from Michigan State, drives through the extra point. And a little something to build on for the Tar Heels when they head to the dressing room. Now trailing 24-7. After a 74-yard drive that took just 4 plays in 1 minute and 1 second.
Darian Durant, the key on a quarterback draw that's not planned is to make the decision quickly, and he tucks it, and that's just a great job looking for open field back against the grain. And all of a sudden, we've got ourselves a football game. This team proved to be a second half unit a week ago up at Syracuse, a very tough place to come up with a victory. I need some more heroics from Durant if they're going to pull that off against this Texas team.
Coming up on the Valvoline halftime show, John Saunders and Terry Bowden. They're having fun in Times Square. We've done great work all day today with this terrific lineup of college football all day long here on ABC Sports. Topher Roberts, the former walk-on, will kick off. He also played soccer here as a freshman. Lost the battle to be the field goal kicker with Orner in the preseason. But is the kickoff man. He squibs it. And it's fielded by Brett Robin, who keeps bobbing along to the 49-yard line of North Carolina. And time for a couple of plays now. After a 25-yard return, they have 11 seconds left.
It's a situation where special teams hurt you. And I wouldn't be surprised if Mack Brown, his offensive coordinator, get together and formulate a plan to go ahead and hit a pass here and set up a field goal for Mangum. And they're not kicking the ball deep there, Sean. May end up hurting North Carolina. One positive I can find from this Tar Heels offensive performance in the first half, they have had 3 bona fide drives. 2 have ended prematurely, one on an interception, one on a long missed field goal by Orner. But at least Durant and his troops have proven the ability to move the football.
Mangum's longest field goal of his career is 51 last year against Carolina in Austin. Sims throws incomplete. Didn't have anybody open. And now he'll likely just heave it into the end zone and hope for a catch or a pass interference penalty. Timms had a little working vacation with his four primary wide receivers, Williams, Johnson, Thomas, and Jeffrey, invited them up to the Sims family home in New Jersey for a week over the summer, did a lot of fishing, played video games, but every day they'd also go to the local high school and work on throwing and catching under the watchful eye of Phil Sims, Chris's dad, the former great Giant quarterback, who offered his advice. Chris forced backwards, now steps into a deep throw. He fell down as he threw it, almost intercepted. But Chris Curry and Chris Hawkins got in each other's way. Late flag thrown. And if it's against Carolina, they might get another chance. It was thrown very late. There was pushing and shoving after the ball had hit the ground and the teams had started in the locker room.
Sims bought some time in the pocket. And the reason why he went to the turf late on that play is he did not want to get cleaned up. There was a linebacker that drew a bead on it.
After the play, unnecessary roughness on North Carolina. The penalty will be enforced on the kickoff of the second half.
It's a carryover.
Here's a last shot, the Hail Mary down the field, and look at him get down. That wasn't the penalty right there, and a nice job by Defonte Coleman to pull off of the tackle.
Valvoline halftime show with John and Terry coming up next. Number two, Texas by 17 at the half.
The Valvoline halftime show brought to you by Valvoline's Max Life, the first motor oil formulated for higher mileage engines. From Times Square in New York, John Saunders and Terry Bowden.
24-7 is great if you're serving Slurpees. It's not that great if the score of your football game. These fans will let you know that they're a time score as well. But at this point, Texas has dominated North Carolina. Chris Sims is what we've expected of Chris Sims over the last few years.
Well, he needed to play well here. This is not Oklahoma, but it's a big TV game. Their first time for us all to see him. He's playing outstanding. Sharp passes, putting the receivers right on their fingertips. He's really doing the thing he needs to do in a big game like this. But it's their defense. Number one in the nation last year. They look to be just as good as last year.
Nebraska also out of the Big 12 playing at Penn State. Penn State coming off back-to-back losing seasons. And this little red Cornhusker says we'd like to make it three in a row as well. Larry Johnson, 7 yards, runs this one out and in as Penn State grabs the early lead, 7-0. But Nebraska comes back with the power move as well. Judd Davies, 2 yards for the touchdown, ties it at 7. But at halftime, a couple of field goals, Penn State has the lead. And they don't look like a team that was 5-6 the last couple of years. They look like a team that's building confidence, and that can go far this season.
John, that's why they're playing with more emotion. They're playing like they want this game more. They're excited. They're keeping that 108,000 people, that crowd in the game, and they're giving Nebraska fits. Nebraska looks like they just don't look dominant. They're not dominant on defense. They don't make any big plays on offense. They can win this game, but this does not look like a Nebraska team that's going to hang on to those polls and those voters.
Yeah, they have to win the way they win, which is powering that football. Now, in the ACC last year, Florida State didn't win it. Maryland won it, but Maryland did not beat Florida State last year, and more of the same in this game. Chris Ricks, 20 yards to Anquan Boldin. Great fingertip grab. It was 13-0. Then Ricks, one more time, 56 yards to Tallman Gardner. Defender falls down, so he just has to scurry into the end zone. 30-0 is the score. They've just started the third quarter. Ricks, a couple of touchdown passes. You saw Boldin with a touchdown reception. Maryland is 0-12 against Florida State all time.
Well, Florida State wants to win that ACC title again. You got to beat last year's champion, and they're doing it right now. But there are more things being told to these guys by my dad. They're being told, hey, you were ahead 31-7, you were ahead 23-0, and you let down the second half. I don't want to see that in the second half at all.
UTEP facing Oklahoma. UTEP gave up over 70 points last week. So what would Oklahoma do against them? John Schopper, the quarterback, is picked up by Antonio Perkins. We'll take this one back for the touchdown. He's got a lot of ground to cover as well. Steps over one guy there. A big miss. A nice cutback.
touchdown. Nate Hibble has two touchdown passes. Quentin Griffin has a touchdown run. This is the Oklahoma team you expected, of course, against UTEP. It should be easy. But this is a team that let down in the second half last week against Alabama.
That's right, and they still have question marks with their offense. I don't think they have a power running game. They can't run the ball when they want to. They only run it well when the defense lets them, and that's what they have to work on, a power running game.
And defense is not going to be enough alone. Right. This is one of the best defenses in the country. Ohio facing Florida. Florida, remember last week they lost to Miami. Yes, a 40-minute rain delay with some lightning and some bad weather in the area. Ernest Graham, two-yard touchdown run. As Ohio, you saw, had the lead 3-0. That made it 7-3. Rex Grossman finally gets him going, 18 yards to Aaron Walker. 14-6 at that point. They ran some option as well. Ernest Graham has two touchdown runs, so they pull away. 34-6 is the final. How's the psyche of this team after that big loss to Miami?
Well, it was so close at halftime. With Tennessee coming up next, I say it's still a problem. I say these guys are still worried about, do they have the right system? Do they have the right coaches?
Yeah, Miami makes them look and say, where's Steve Spurrier? Ron Zook, of course, got the first win, but after that, it was a struggle. Phil Rivers with a touchdown pass. T.A. McClendon with two touchdown runs. NC State all over Wake Forest, 32-13. And Miami of Ohio comes up short against LSU. It's at halftime right now. Matt Mock with two touchdown passes there. And LSU looks like they will march on to the victory as well. Again, for Texas, the question is, Chris Sims, fair or not? Over his career, he's been great against teams they should beat, not great against teams that they shouldn't beat. This game means something, but it's going to count down the line where we're going to see how good he is.
That's right. Well, North Carolina plays pretty good defense, and you've got to play well. Chris Sims, he's had so much pressure on him. Have a great game. Throw the good plays. Don't do things that would lose the game.
All right, right now we've got a big lead. It's going to be tough to lose that game. This is the Valvoline Halftime Show from Times Square. Valvoline Halftime Show next Saturday here on ABC, 3:30 Eastern Time. Many of you will see the surprising Irish of Notre Dame take on Michigan State. Others will be elsewhere. Check local listings for the game available in your area. You coaches like to talk about those statement games early in the season. How about statement games as a conference? That was the story for the Big Ten today, a chance to show the rest of the country that they were back and should be ranked in the top 10. Greg Krenzel would lead his squad back, and it's easy to do that when you hand off to this freshman. Maurice Clarett, 3 yards out for a touchdown. You want to see great offensive line work? Clarett can waltz into the end zone for the touchdown. What a day. 31 carries, 230 yards, two touchdowns, and 196 of those yards coming in the second half where he just credited his offensive line.
Well, the reason he had such a great second half is because their defense is awesome. They believe in their defense. They were only up, 7-6 at halftime. They stuck with the game plan. They didn't panic, and they just overpowered them in the second half.
So Ohio State gets the big win for the Big Ten against the Pac-10. How would Michigan do against the surprising Irish of Notre Dame and Tyrone Willingham? Still looking for his first offensive touchdown despite a 2-0 record. He gets it. Ryan Grant from 2 yards out. Give it to Grant one more time from 3 yards out. It was 22-17. But John Navarre would lead Michigan back. In fact, if he could get this two-point conversion, he'd tie the game at 25 apiece. But it's knocked away by Shane Walton. Not done. Navarre has a chance to lead them for a game-winning field goal. Who's there again? Navarre gets hit. Shane Walton has the interception. The Irish have the win. First 3-0 start since Lou Holtz back in 1996. And the first win against a top 10 team since 1998. That was Michigan as well.
Well, they've had defense all year. They've had specialty teams all year. Now they've got offense. Why? Because they're more comfortable with this West Coast offense. They're not thinking so much. They're playing football. And when you play football without thinking, you make big plays.
All right, the number one team in the nation, Miami. Did you have any doubt after the win at the Swamp last week? But today they had to go to Franklin Field where it's so tough. Mike McGann, 10-yard loss here. Miami's up 31-14. It actually was a 21-14 game at one point. Willis McGahee had four touchdown runs. This was his fourth of the game. They missed the point after. Didn't matter. 44-21. So Temple, a moral victory is they got the game to 21-14. But this team has now won 25 consecutive games.
I said before the season that Miami may have lost too much senior leadership, and I still say that's an issue. You've got to be pretty mature, have a lot of leadership to handle great success. Will they get overconfident? Will they not try hard in every game? We got to watch that down the road this season.
They still have Florida State, Tennessee, and, of course, they end the season against Virginia Tech, rather, and we've seen how good they have been this year. Let's wrap up the rest of the highlights in the SEC. South Carolina facing Georgia. Corey Jenkins, we picked off in the end zone. Watch this. Just moves in, knocks the ball right back into his own hands, and that is a touchdown. And then South Carolina's Andrew Pinnock fumbles the pitch. Lou Holtz looks on as Georgia wins it 13-7. Almost throws a visor, pulls it back. Oregon facing Idaho. Idaho's defense is a struggling team, but Jason Fife will make him pay for that. 24 yards to Matt Floberg, who does most of the work. Just picks it up, his shoe tops, and then rumbles the rest of the way. 58-21 was the final. Fife with a great day. USC against Colorado, and Carson Palmer goes 32 yards to Malifo McKenzie. And McKenzie, look at that move there, and the power. And runs it in. Had one running on the ground as well. 40-3 as Pete Carroll watches the victory right there. This is the Valvoline Halftime Show. We'll continue with more from New York in just a moment. Times Square Stadium. Last week at the Delphi Indy 300, Sam Hornish Jr. won the closest race in IRL history. Tomorrow at 3 o'clock Eastern Time on ABC Sports, Hornish looks to hold off Elil Castroneves and win the IRL title. A great day tomorrow on ABC Sports, starting with Formula One Italian Grand Prix at 1 o'clock Eastern Time. Back to college football now. California against Michigan State. Cal won one game last year, looking to win their third this year. Kyle Bowler had a terrific day. Little pitch to LaShawn Ward, and then he sneaks out of the backfield, takes the pass back, 14 yards. Nice move right there at the two, and Bowles his way in. They had a 22-0 lead. Then Bowler, 23-yard pass to Joe Igber, who does the rest of the work. Bowler, 19 of 33, 232 yards, and two touchdowns. Northern Illinois against Wisconsin. It's a tough day for the Big Ten, but Brooks Bollinger bails out Wisconsin. They go to 4-0. He had 270 yards passing and two rushing touchdowns. BYU against Nevada. BYU, remember, a great year last year until they stumbled at the end. Well, Nevada quarterback here, Zach Threadgill, says we're going to make you stumble early. 14 yards to Eric Streelman. 24-14, but BYU fighting their way back. Lance Pendleton in at quarterback. Toby Christensen has the pass, but it's short of the first down. Time expires, and Nevada gets the win. 31-28 is the final, so BYU doesn't wait till the end of the season to lose this time. Right now, let's take you back out to the second half.
Thank you, John. Here in Chapel Hill, the Marching Tar Heels, under the direction of Jeff Fuchs, are entertaining this overflow crowd at Keenan Stadium. At the half, it's 24-7, Texas leading North Carolina. ABC Sports presentation of college football will return after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
You're watching ABC Sports, the class of college football.
Welcome back to Chapel Hill at halftime. Number two, Texas leading North Carolina 24-7. Sean McDonough along with David Norrie. David, for the Longhorn fans who are watching, this is reminiscent of the opening game of the season against North Texas. The Horns dominate early, then seem to lose their way.
Well, they have to hope that doesn't hold true for the second half. And if North Carolina is going to get back into this game, I think they might want to go some more no huddle like they did at the end of the half. If they can get a touchdown, get the crowd back into it, they can also get the running game involved again. So this opening drive of the second half is going to be very critical for John Bunning and his Tar Heels.
Because of the penalty on the last play of the half against North Carolina, Texas will kick off from the 50-yard line. Richmond McGee kicks off and just lines it right through the back of the end zone. So the Tar Heels will begin from. Darian Durant helped give them some hope heading into the locker room. And he ran for a 27-yard touchdown. That was the final score of the half after Texas built a 24-0 lead. Durant 7 of 15 passing for 91 yards and an interception. Chesley Borders, the motion man. Jock Lewis in shifty running. Out to the 27. Derek Johnson made the tackle. We take a look at the first half stats. 291 yards to 156. An excellent balance by Texas. Led by Benson in his 115 yards rushing. They rushed for 116 and threw for 175. Second and 2.5. Lewis belted down short of the first down by about a half a yard. The third down and 1. Lewis is the Tar Heels leading rusher to this point. He carried for 44 in the first half, now has 52. The Nissan drive summary, not much to brag about for North Carolina until the end.
The drives of the missed field goal and the interception, those were two drives in deep into Texas territory and no points to show for.
And a first down they really need to pick up here to keep whatever momentum they might have built up at the end of the half. Lewis has the first down, breaks out of a tackle and finally gets taken down by Lee Jackson at the 33. First and 10 Tar Heels. Ball spotted at the 34 yard line. And the I formation now with Hedgecock, the fullback. Durant across the line of scrimmage. And he runs out to the 42 yard line. Well, good movement by North Carolina to begin the third quarter, and I know that makes our guest very happy. We're pleased to be joined by John Swofford, commissioner of the ACC, former athletic director here at North Carolina, and a former football player here too. Looks like your old school's trying to get back into this thing.
Sean, I hope so. That hopefully the momentum there at the end of the half will carry over into this half.
An exciting season for ACC. This is the 50th anniversary of the conference.
It is, Sean, and that's something we'll be commemorating through the entire season and have named a 50-year team. In football that we'll be honoring in Atlanta at the ACC All-Conference Banquet in December, and we're honoring 50-year teams in all of our sports actually throughout the year. It's an exciting time for us.
You must have a little bit of divided loyalty despite all of your hats that would tie you to North Carolina, because I know you're very fond of Mack Brown. You worked with him here at North Carolina. He told us the other day you and he scheduled this game when he was at North Carolina. He said, if I had known I was going to be at Texas, I wouldn't have scheduled the game.
Well, we did. And Mack and I had a terrific relationship when he was here, and he did a terrific job for the University of North Carolina. And it's great to see him having the success that he's having at Texas, although I wish he would have a little less of that success tonight.
And John Bunting, I believe he told us the other day, you two lockered next to each other.
Well, we did. By our senior year, I'd thrown enough interceptions as a quarterback to become a defensive back, and John was number 43, and I became number 44, so we lockered together. Tremendous leader as a player. John was the best on-field leader and locker room leader as a player that I've ever been around in my entire career, and I think he'll do a terrific job for the University of North Carolina.
It is a first down for the Tar Heels from the 44-yard line. And the handoff to Lewis. He avoided the first tackle by Michael Huff and turned it into a gain out to the 49-yard line. John, how about ACC football? I know for a lot of years, as a matter of fact, Mack Brown joked about with us the other day, the perception was it was Florida State and the eight dwarfs. But with Maryland doing what they did and the other teams jumping up and beating Florida State last year, do you think the parity that seems to be arriving is good for the league?
I do, Sean. I think it's coming. A tremendous commitment by our schools to the sport itself, as evidenced by some of the hires they've made with the head coaches. Very strong group of head coaches in our league right now. Great facilities. Last year we had 7. Nice game there. Had 7 teams bowl eligible for the first time in our history, and that's out of a 9-team league. And we were 4-2 in bowls. So an awfully lot of good things going on with Atlantic Coast Conference football right now.
We congratulate you on your outstanding leadership in this conference. And I won't ask any BCS questions tonight.
Okay, you can ask Mike Trangisi those questions this year, Sean.
I'm sure you're happy to have handed that off.
Well, it was a great experience, and the BCS is something that I think is good for college football. It has some holes in it that hopefully we can plug, but I think basically it's good.
He's John Swofford, one of the great leaders in college athletics, and thanks again, John.
Sean, thanks for having me.
Always great
good to
see
have you here in the ACC.
And the proud Carolina alum happy as the Tar Heels continue on the move. Durant, a nice run to pick up a first down. And now the pass play has them to the 34-yard line. Chesley Borders on the last reception. They're on the move at the 36. Durant had trouble with a low snap, turns it into a gain, hangs on to the ball as they try to strip him. Lee Jackson was trying to pry it out, but it's a first down to the 29-yard line. Let's go to Times Square Stadium again. Here's John.
Well, one of the quarterbacks we talked about at the start of the day and throughout the year is Dave Ragone. And here he goes, 28 yards to Dante Stillman. Gets this ball deep, not into the end zone for the touchdown. It sets up a one-yard run by Henry Miller. And this game is all tied up at 7 apiece.
Perhaps this game about to be a lot more competitive as Carolina's on an impressive drive. Meanwhile, Lee Jackson is involved in the last tackle. A little wobbly as he gets up. And that's a major concern with his lengthy history of injuries. We alluded to that in the first half. 19 games missed over the last two seasons. Here's the 10th play of the drive upcoming. First and 10 from just inside the 30. Out of the I formation, Lewis gets through a tackler. Is he down? Yes. At the 26-yard line. Still managed to turn what looked to be a loss into a gain as Cedric Griffin could not get him on the ground at the corner.
Well, Jock Lewis has been a big part of this resurgence in this North Carolina offense, especially on this drive. The knee is down. Solid call by the officiating crew, but John Punney knows that his team has a lot of momentum, especially coming off that last drive in the first half.
Solid performance by Lewis and movement. Looked like the Tar Heels were taking off early.
Prior to the snap, false start. North Carolina, 5 yards, still second down.
If you're Darian Durant in this situation, you have to make sure that you're going to be secure with the football. You'd like to come up with 7 for your team, but a field goal, if you settle for a field goal, you cut this to a 2-touchdown game, and a home crowd playing into it, it makes things a little bit tighter on the Longhorn.
Durant had a step up to avoid the rush, throws it into double coverage again, intercepted. Second interception he's thrown to Dakari Pearson in the end zone. They are killers. And John Bunning can't bear to watch.
Darian Durant just locked on his receiver once again, made the same mistake late in the second quarter. And this mistake hurts his Tar Heels even more.
John Saunders here in New York. Penn State playing before a crowd. Now we're told of almost 111,000 watching as Michael Robinson goes 8 yards for the touchdown. They lead Nebraska by 12.
Where they just open the doors and tell more people, whoever was driving by, come on in. Two killer interceptions by Durant tonight for North Carolina. They were at the Texas 23 and then at the 31 when he threw two INTs in the end zone. Benson punished. Michael Waddell delivered the big blow. Dexter Reed, Doug Justice, all around the pile.
That's a beautiful drive for Durant until this play. And as a quarterback, when you're taking a shot down the right side, you've got, go ahead and freeze it right there. You've got to keep track of the free safety. This is a man-free coverage. Sam Aiken, man-to-man outside with Nathan Vasher. Durant loses track of the free safety. His second critical mistake in three drives for Durant.
He's been killing them with turnovers here in the early season. Sims trying to set up a screen through the hands of Sloan Thomas. And this offense, which was in rhythm and functioning crisply throughout most of the first half, has gotten very stale and stagnant.
Sims does not have the same running game that he had in the first half. And Durant missed on a couple big opportunities. Two great drives. And he's thrown the ball brilliantly at times in this game. But those two interceptions have stopped this team from getting back in the game. They need a big stop here once again from the defense.
Fans trying to help the defense get off the field. Third down and 10 for Texas. The horns at their own 20. Timeout called by Carolina. They had 12 men on the field. That could prove costly later. John Bunting and the North Carolina Tar Heels. Down 24-7. In need of a stop here on third down and 10 for Texas. The Heels had to burn a timeout because they had 12 men on the field. From their own 20. Sims started the game 5 for 6. He's 3 out of 14 passing since. He's had some dropped. That one's caught, but way short of the first down. Matt Trissel, the fullback, tackled immediately by Kevin Knight.
Boy, Texas.
And a penalty against North Carolina. Critical mistake. They're just making way too many physical and mental mistakes to beat the number two team in the country.
Boy, oh boy, is that a big one.
Roughing the passer on Carolina. 15 yards from the last run. First down.
Sims is going to take a big shot at the end of this play. Chapman coming off the right end. And boy,
that's
a pretty questionable call right there. I mean,
that's a bad call.
I would give Dante Coates the benefit of the doubt. That wasn't a full step. That was a half step. And he was right in Sims' face on the delivery.
That is really a bad call.
Tough call.
And extends the possession for Texas. Benson, like the passing game, the running game has gone south for Texas as well. Chris Curry up from the safety spot to force the play and stop it for no gain. Let's head back to Times Square Stadium. Here's John Saunders.
Well, Sean, Penn State, big surprise against Nebraska. Rich Gardner is going to step in front of this pass and sees nothing but daylight on the way to the end zone. 42 yards on the interception return. 26-7, Penn State.
I'm surprised by the margin. I'm not surprised Penn State is winning, David. I don't think Nebraska's all that good.
Big day for the Big Ten coming into today's action. And couple teams have held up in a big way. Ohio State.
And to me, that was more of a late hit that Sims just took when he slid than the one that got flagged a moment ago. He went into a head first dive already with one Tar Heel around him, and the second guy gave him a later pop than the one that was flagged against Coates.
Yeah, late contact. Here comes a count later than the roughing the.
Not that that's roughing
penalty.
Either, but it's certainly a penalty if the other one's a penalty.
Now, you don't figure to get the roughing the quarterback call here at Chapel Hill. John Bunting has to be a little bit disturbed. It's a big stop from his defense, and this drive stays alive.
Another third down. The Tar Heel defense tries to get off the field. Sims, did he get it off? Yes, say the officials. Lofts up the fade for Roy Williams. Incomplete. Very well covered along the near sideline by Michael Waddell.
Chris Sims is going to hand signal. He sees the man-to-man. He sees the blitz. He hand signals outside to Roy Williams. Calls for the go route. And he comes close to hitting. Nice coverage down the sideline. And once again, Darian Durant off the hook as a result of his defense coming up big.
Here's the punt by Bradford. Waddell caught it at the 17. Great return. He cuts it up the middle. And a nifty run back to the 34. 38-yard punt, 17-yard return. Again, the long snapper, Cullen Leffler, made the tackle. ABC Sports presentation of college football is brought to you by Nissan and your Nissan dealer. By Pacific Life, annuities, insurance, and investments rely on the strength of Pacific Life. By Gatorade Thirst Quencher, Gatorade, is it in you? And by the delicious flame-broiled Whopper from Burger King. At BK, you got it.
North Carolina on defense continues to get a safety up in the box, and he's been giving Sims the opportunity to hit some deep balls down the field. It's only a matter of time, Sean. North Carolina better capitalize soon.
And a roughing the passer penalty cost him a little field position and about 2 minutes off the clock. Redding in pursuit of Durant. Durant got away, man wide open. Lewis at the 30. Flag down at the line of scrimmage. Thrown by the official on the line, the far side of the field. The play went all the way to the 23 and is going to come all the way back.
Now this is a shame for Tar Heel fans. Watch Skip Seagraves finish off the block. It looks like Redding has the sack. The left hand on the back creates time for Durant. That's nice vision down the field by Durant to pick up his running back down the field. John Bunning, furious.
An illegal formation on North Carolina. There were only six on the line. 5 yards, replay first down.
Get a look here, Sean, to see how many were on the line of scrimmage. They're going to say that there were only six men on the line of scrimmage for the Tar Heels. And if that was the case, inexcusable mistake.
John Bunting furious at this Big 12 officiating crew. Two, three, four, five. They must say the left tackle's not on the line.
Well, here's it in a tight end in motion, and maybe when the tight end got set.
Be kidding me. I don't blame John Bunting for being upset at all. It was a phantom roughing the passer call, and that appeared to be a phantom call as well.
And the tight end was in motion, so unless he stepped up on the line of scrimmage, another tough call against the Tar Heels.
Jock Lewis, the ball carrier, on first and 15. They've had so many momentum killers, and yet they're trying to hang in there. And John Bunting talked about how thrilled he was with the effort in the opener. Despite 9 turnovers, they had a chance to beat a good Miami of Ohio team. At the end of the game, they're on the 23-yard line, firing it toward the end zone with a chance to win it. And Miami held on for the 27-21 win. Here's the throw and catch. Darrell Mitchell, the freshman. All the way to the 32, and there are no flags on the play. 34-yard gain. Rod Babers made the tackle.
Now we talked about Durant's ability to throw the ball down the field, the deep throws, and this is a deep dig route, a crossing route, and what a catch by the freshman. I mean, he extends in traffic, risk taking a big shot from a safety. Another angle, great feet in the pocket by Durant, throws the ball on time. Great play between quarterback and wide receiver.
There's a true freshman from Winston-Salem, Mitchell, with great speed. Quarterback draw, Durant inside the 20, inside the 10, and down at the 7-yard line. Corey Redding, the defensive end, all the way downfield to make the tackle. They'll mark it down at the 6. A gain of 25. First and goal. Tar Heels trying to make a game of it in the third quarter.
To be fair to it, I don't think it's the officials' mistakes. I think it's some of the mistakes of this North Carolina team that has affected their comeback. But Durant has been relentless. Even with the 2 picks, even with the poor decisions, he continues to make the big throws. And what a job he's doing for John Bunning with the quarterback draw.
Seeing a lot of outside rush. That quarterback draw's been there a lot for them. Inside Lewis, fumble! Recovered by Texas, then it came out again. And it looks like it's a touchdown! Jason Brown, the center, wound up with it when it appeared the Longhorns had recovered in the end zone for a touchback. It squirted out, and Carolina with a miraculous score. It was Rod Babers, old stone hands again, who couldn't wrap up the football.
Now you talk about getting lucky. This might have been the end for North Carolina. And if Babers can collect the football in the end zone, it's going to be a long road back. And Brown, alert in the end zone, covers the football. 4:08 to go in the third quarter. Texas is going to have to go back to work on offense.
And orders extra point, makes it a 10-point game. Jason Brown, all 311 pounds of him. The sophomore from Henderson, North Carolina, with a touchdown. It's 24-14, Texas.
Rated E.
Topher Roberts ready to kick off. The crowd back into it here at sold-out Canaan Stadium. 14 unanswered points by the Tar Heels. And for the second game in a row, Texas, after building a big lead, has lost its focus. Selvin Young, the true freshman, returns the kickoff. Gets outside and is finally chased out, and a flag thrown on the tackle. Michael Waddell chased him out. Based on where they threw the flag, you wonder if he grabbed the face mask to do it. A 38-yard return. And the Horns hope that's another momentum turner in their favor. It'll be the 15-yard face mask. So they'll start this possession in North Carolina territory.
And Mack Brown says, we'll take a little of that. You cannot give Sims and his offensive teammates these kinds of opportunities without a play from scrimmage. And it looks like the initial blow to the face mask came from a Longhorn. Selvin Young got up into the face mask of a Tar Heel right there. Wow.
Well, John Bunting, I think, is more focused on the officiating right now than anything else.
Yeah, his team has been victimized a couple times here. There's a face mask, and then another face mask comes late. But that isn't a 15-yard variety. I mean, two face masks in between offensive and defensive player, and they were brief.
Sims after play action pass. Zings one to a wide open Roy Williams. Inside the 15. And finally taken down at the 10-yard line. 35 yards.
As we said, it's only a matter of time. North Carolina dedicating a lot of defenders up on the line of scrimmage. Sims, another great play fake. And this is like taking candy from a baby. Dig route, Roy Williams over the middle. Ball delivered right on time. And now Texas is knocking on the door, right back.
Plenty of Longhorn fans here. First and goal. One of the rushers upended on the rush. Touchdown! Great throw by Sims to Chad Stevens, the tight end. And the Longhorns respond immediately after their lead had dwindled to 10. And Coach Bunting still after the officials.
And this is what happens when you give Texas chances. And North Carolina coming off a score, but they gave up some big opportunities with interceptions. And how about the ball from Sims? And he gets that left foot, that back foot loaded. Stevens not well known for his pass catching ability. Stout blocker, but nevertheless a nice route by Chad, and the ball arrives right on time.
First career touchdown for Stevens, a senior from Cypress, Texas. And the crowd very quiet now as Mangum's extra point makes it 31-14. Fans are booing, and they're booing the officiating crew.
Chris Sims gets comfortable in the pocket. This Texas offense becomes a machine, and he fits that in about a 2-foot by 2-foot window. That's called laying the ball right on the spot. And Sims on the sideline
talking with the teammates and talking about maybe going out and getting some more next time they get the ball.
We spoke with Chris yesterday. Obviously, he's come under heavy criticism from time to time in Austin and throughout the state of Texas. And we asked him his thoughts about dealing with the criticism.
Nobody's harder on me than myself. And I've always been like that. So what other people think, you know, it doesn't bother me, because really, if I play a good game, I'm the one that goes in there and watches the film with the coaches, and they tell me I play a good game, and you know, they have all the experience, they've been around, and that's all that matters to me.
And by his own admission, Chris played a terrible game against Colorado in the Big 12 championship. That he felt great in the first quarter, then it all just came apart when he started making turnovers in the second quarter, was benched and did not start the Holiday Bowl. Major Applewhite led them to the come from behind win over Washington. How about the story Chris told us yesterday? After the game against Colorado, he had 40 voicemail messages. Some fraternity had published his number on the internet, and he had all kinds of nasty phone messages. He went over to the fraternity house shortly thereafter, and the ringleader, the real tough guy on the internet, wouldn't even come out of the house to talk to Chris. All he wanted to do was talk to him, the guy hid in the fraternity house.
I wouldn't want to confront Chris Sims at 6'5", about 225. And, you know, that was tough for me to watch that film of the second quarter, because I know the type of competitor this kid is. I've been involved in college football now for about 20 years, and I have not met a classier kid at the quarterback position than Chris Sims, bar none. And he has all the talent to take him 10, 15 years deep into the NFL.
Well, the fans and media down in Texas would be on his case. If they don't want him, there are plenty of other campuses around the country where they would die to have Chris Sims be their quarterback. Almost every other one in the country, in fact. Danny Rumley made the catch, and we remind you that next Saturday, ABC Sports has another great day of college football. Number 9, Virginia Tech heads into Aggieland. And then at 3:30, others will see Notre Dame and Michigan State, BYU and Georgia Tech, Colorado and UCLA. That's next Saturday, 3:30 Eastern on ABC Sports. The class of college football. They're trying to set up a screen. It's very well defended. Durant wise to just throw it away.
How about the Fighting Irish as we get a look at the Tar Heel faithful? A little edgy after some contact out of bounds. Tyrone Willingham coming up with another big victory today.
Darian Durant announced in February he was going to transfer out of North Carolina, even though he alternated in every two series last year with Curry, and with Ronald Curry graduating, it was apparent that Durant was going to be the starter this year. He didn't really say publicly why he intended to leave. He told the coaches he just didn't like it here. But then he changed his mind in April.
There was no foul. The receiver in the area.
They had thrown a flag for intentional grounding, but they picked that one up.
Well, Sean, I have no earthly idea why a kid like Durant would want to transfer off a beautiful campus like Chapel Hill. And he hit 63% of his balls last year at 17 touchdowns, and that was splitting time with Ronald Curry.
Third down and 5. Durant throws it quickly, very close to the first down. They needed the 30-yard line. Will they give him the spot? It doesn't appear so, by about an inch.
It's a huge spot.
Somehow you knew that was going to happen. Chesley Borders, the receiver. Michael Huff seemed to stop him just short of the 30-yard line. They don't need to measure it, because all the nose thereof needed to reach the 30. I thought I read John Bunning's lips saying, let's go for it. And it looks like they are. Nope. Yes, they will. Just sending a different personnel grouping, but the offense is going to stay on the field. Extra tight ends and Jock Lewis into the game.
This is a tough call right here, because if you don't pick it up, and the way Ruth Sims and his troops are rolling with the football, game may be over. Do or die.
Durant puts his head down and appeared to pick up the first down. He did. First down, North Carolina. Let's check in at Times Square Stadium with John Saunders.
Sean, Nebraska and Penn State and the Nittany Lions look like a team of old here. Michael Robinson takes his ball, breaks a couple of tackles, and then into the backfield, and there's no one there. 11 yards on the run. They scored on five consecutive possessions and lead Nebraska 33-7.
That makes that visit to Lincoln for the Longhorns later on this year look a little less daunting.
That offensive line in Nebraska just doesn't seem to be what it's been in the past. Of course, they lost Eric Crouch. Low snap handled by Durant. He runs away from the rush. He's across the line of scrimmage, delivers a stiff arm, and runs out of bounds at the 37. Gave the stiff arm to Cedric Griffin. Here's the Pacific Life game summary.
Early on in the game, Texas having their way, jumping out to a 24-7 lead at half, and the touchdown, the fumble recovery by Brown pulls the Tar Heels within 10. Sims strikes right back to Chad Stevens, a big tight end, and a 17-point deficit. This is a 9-1-1 call right here. Durant's got approach. This is four down territory the rest of this drive.
Quarterback draw again. He waited patiently for some running room, and he's very near another first down. Looks like they'll mark him down about a half yard shy at the 40. Derek Johnson, the sophomore from Waco, made the tackle. He was among their team leaders in tackles last year, even though he wasn't a starter. By his estimate, only played about 30% of the downs. Fans are really on the officials now. They don't like this spot either. You heard more boos in the background. And now they've stopped the clock to confirm.
Well, you're going to get a call go against you from time to time, and you got to play through it. That's all part of football.
5-5.
Texas Tech, a non-conference win today for the Big 12. And Missouri losing to Bowling Green. Iowa State won the Battle of Iowa. Mean Green of North Texas a loss. They lost to Texas 2 weeks ago. Third down and one. Lewis bounced outside, then back inside for the first down. He played last year as a true freshman. Jock Lewis. He's from Northeastern High School in Elizabeth City, North Carolina. He rushed for over 5,000 yards and 70 touchdowns in his high school career. He's run for 77 yards tonight.
He's been impressive on that last run. Great vision, bouncing the ball outside.
Final half minute of the third quarter. Durant threw behind his intended receiver, Aiken, and a late flag thrown. That might have been influenced by the crowd as well. Nathan Vasher will be called for pass interference as he rescued what was going to be an incompletion because the ball seemed to be pretty well behind Sam Aiken.
Yeah, tough to get around Sam Aiken to make that play without contact. Aiken goes 6'2", 205 pounds. Ball thrown on time, front pocket. And the contact came early. Vasher plays aggressively. The Texas corners always play aggressively. Going back to Quentin Jammer a year ago. Babers on the other side, and that was the right call.
Jammer certainly made a nice transition from safety to corner. And they expect that Vasher, with his great athletic ability, will be able to do the same. Jammer, the fifth player taken in the entire draft by San Diego. Durant, lots of time, going deep for Aiken. Incomplete, and a late flag thrown again. Vasher had the primary coverage. Again, Pearson, the safety, coming over. That play looked a lot like the two interceptions in the end zone, but apparently a much better result this time for North Carolina.
Yeah, the only difference is Durant gets the ball up quicker, and that avoids an interception. But watch the helmet here by Pearson. He leads with the helmet, helmet on helmet. That's a dangerous play. Number nine coming over, drew a bead, led with the crown of his helmet. You're going to see a flag pretty much every time for that kind of action in the secondary.
And it is a personal foul against Pearson for leading with the helmet, because clearly it was not pass interference.
That's a violent play. He may have been a glancing blow, but it was helmet to helmet. Finished him off with the shoulder pad. once again, North Carolina in scoring position.
First and 10 at the 31-yard line. 15 seconds left in the third quarter. Tar Heels trail 24-0. They're down by 17 at the half. Got it to within 10. Now down by 17 again. Here's a blitz. They run a reverse. Chesley Borders has Durant out blocking. Gets chopped down with a first down at the 14-yard line. The great speed of Derek Johnson again might have saved the touchdown. It is a 17-yard gain.
On a reverse, the quarterback leads the blockers. His fake takes him naturally in that direction. And Durant providing the wall. Derek Johnson with the great speed, as you said, Sean, running the play down from behind.
I think Durant was a little too far ahead of the play. He could have stayed and blocked Johnson. Instead, he went for a man deeper downfield. Lewis run down from behind by Miguel McKay on the last play of the third quarter. Terrific play by McKay, who was born in Jamaica, grew up playing soccer and cricket. ABC Sports presentation of college football will return after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
You got it.
You're watching college football on ABC Sports Championship Television.
Back in beautiful Chapel Hill for the fourth quarter and the second largest crowd in Keenan Stadium history, 60,500 on hand, surpassed only by the game in 97 between the Tar Heels and Seminoles. And both teams came in undefeated. FSU gave the Heels their only loss of that season against Mac Brown. First play of the fourth quarter is second and 11. North Carolina. There's a man wide open. Touchdown, Sam Aiken.
Stay in the short zone, and Aiken runs right by, and the safety's late getting over.
Davers and Vasher nearly collided. A 15-yard touchdown pass. The extra point up and good by Dan Orner, and the Tar Heels refuse to go away. All but 5 seconds of the fourth quarter remaining. It's a 10-point game again. Bunting in the preseason started an answer the bell campaign. He wanted his team to respond during times of adversity, during the tough two-a-days and the scorching heat. And when situations were against them in ball games during the season, they've answered the bell tonight after falling behind 24-0. Vasher let the kickoff go, rather Selden Young did. And then downed it. Let's look at the Pontiac performance drive summary and the performance lately of the Tar Heels. Outstanding.
Yeah, it's coming on the heels of an interception. So three great drives in a row, and four if you go all the way back to the last drive of the first half.
On the heels of an interception. Very good, David.
And take a look at Aiken right here on the fade route up the field. Rod Babers is going to get picked off here. Freeze it right there. Number 21. He's trying to get out here into the flat. And both defenders collide. Nice ball on the fake. Safety late getting over the top.
Deafening noise now. Benson trying to get it going again. He had 115 yards rushing at the half. He also had 115 through three quarters. Did not rush for a single yard. In the third quarter, Dexter Reed chopped him down, but a quality gain of 8. It'll be second down and 2.
Benson has become the forgotten man in this offensive attack for Texas, and they need to get back to that mix of run and passing that was so successful in the first half.
Sims gesturing. And the rest of his mates communicating. Benson straight ahead through a big hole. Again, Reed, the safety, flies up to chop him down to the 36-yard line. Benson spent some time this summer playing professional baseball in the Los Angeles Dodgers organization as a center fielder for the Dodgers rookie league team in Vero Beach. Played in 8 games, hit 217, and decided, you know, I'm really thinking a lot more about football. I think I'm going to go back and get ready for the football season.
The conventional thinking down in Austin has been that that interrupts his progress some, not being with his teammates in the summer and going through football workouts, and I'd have to concur.
They're pounding away with the run now. Just trying to run the clock. And they'll hope that this Tar Heel defense is worn out on this very muggy night. Justice got run over but made the tackle at the 41. 5 more on the run for Benson, who suffered a pinched nerve in his neck in the Big 12 championship game after he collided with Big Mike Williams and did not play in the Holiday Bowl. That bothered him for quite a while in the offseason.
Got off to a great start in that Big 12 championship game and named by his teammates the offensive MVP with all that additional talent offensively for the Longhorns a year ago.
And trying to stick with the run with Benson. That time the heels wise to it. Little or no gain. Will Chapman and Doug Justice. And a big third down upcoming from the Texas 42-yard line.
Things get a little tight here in the fourth quarter. Texas saw the films of Florida State last year. And this North Carolina team feels they can win the big game. They knocked off a number 6 Seminole team a year ago.
Brett Robin is in. On third down and 4, they show blitz. And they come on the blitz. Sims throws for the first down. Roy Williams gets away. He's going to take it to the house. Touchdown, Longhorns, 58 yards. They left Michael Waddell in one-on-one coverage with the blitz coming. And Mac Brown's Longhorns made them pay.
Now this is a lonely feeling. Number 18 in blue. Man-to-man press coverage on the outside. Now you can understand the completion taking place, but if 18 fans on the tackle, 4 has gone to the kitchen.
Second touchdown of the night, now 17 in his career. Establishing a new Texas touchdown reception record. The extra point good. 4 catches, 133 yards for Roy Williams. Back to a 17-point lead for number 2, Texas.
Trust me.
ABC Sports presentation of college football is brought to you by Pontiac, introducing the all-new Vibe. By Verizon Wireless, we never stop working for you. By Olive Garden, where great Italian food tells you when you're here, your family. And by The Gap. Twice North Carolina has moved within 10 points, only to see the Texas Longhorns answer. Mac Brown said yesterday this will be a great test early in the season on the road to prepare them for some very tough road games that lie ahead. The Richmond McGee kickoff returned to the 20 by Jock Lewis. We head back to Times Square Stadium and John Saunders.
Well, Sean, this score keeps getting stranger and stranger. Nebraska, Penn State. This is Larry Johnson from 2 yards out. He has 123 yards and 2 touchdowns, and now 40-7. Good. You make the point that Nebraska, it's tough to go in there, but to get blown out like this, this a surprise.
Yeah, definitely a huge surprise, particularly the margin. And I would imagine now the attendance is up to what, about 120,000? 121,000? They keep on coming.
How about our friend Bobby Bowden saying, you know, if Joe Paterno needs to step it up a little bit or I'm going to catch him, and it sounds like Joe got the message.
Bowden in pursuit of Paterno in the all-time career coaching list. Lewis, nice balance. He's out to the 24. And speaking of that, you know, the pressure mounting on Mac Brown now to win a national championship. He's done a wonderful job, obviously, in his first 4 years at Texas, winning 9 games or more a year, getting him into a bowl game every year, accomplishing a lot of things that this program hasn't done in many years. But the talent is such that the next obvious step is winning a national championship. And Max said to us the other day, well, how long did it take Paterno before he won? How long did it take Tom Osborne? How long did it take Bobby Bowden? Some of the great coaches of all time. He's absolutely right. It's not an easy thing to do. You need some luck along the way. Durant running for his life, tripped up behind the line of scrimmage. A loss of a yard on the play. Brian Pickrell, a true freshman with a bright future. He's a terrific pass rusher. Credited with the sack, first of his career. He's from Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Looking at the touchdown. Give Chris Sims some credit. That's a beautifully thrown ball and a risky ball out in the flat. It's a flat pass to the outside, and it's one thing to play Roy Williams man-to-man. It's another to come up and play him on his nose man-to-man. Pretty tough responsibility there for Waddell. And the Tar Heels get penalized for that defensive call.
Under 11 minutes remaining. Durant with the four-man rush. He zips one into traffic. Aiken could not hang on. Derek Johnson there again. As a sophomore, he is obviously ready to be recognized as one of the great linebackers in the country. They lost all three starting linebackers from last year, but many believe this group might be faster and more athletic and in the long run better than the three terrific players they replaced.
They certainly have the potential on the two deep. A lot of young players playing at number two spots across the board. This is a right call here by John Bunning. 4th and 8, 17-point lead. There's still time to come back. You're going to have to play all your chips right here. Good play to punt it away.
But a bad punt by Lafferty. Landed short and rolled back. 26-yard punt. Longhorns will take over near midfield. Back in control, leading by 17.
You know, we idiot.
Chris Sims and the Longhorns now be looking to run some clock and get out of Chapel Hill with a hard-fought victory. Sims has completed only 12 passes tonight, but he's averaged 23.6 yards on those completions. He's had 7 completions of 20 or more. Cedric Benson against a very fatigued looking defense now, and finally Dexter Reed got him on the ground. Well, Roy Williams just scored the touchdown that perhaps put this one away for Texas. We mentioned earlier he spent the summer 5 days up with Chris Sims. Sims says Williams likes to fish, but not much else about fishing.
He didn't want to put the bait on the hook, but then he'd like to catch the fish and then didn't like to take the fish off the hook after he caught it. So I'd be in my house playing video games with BJ Johnson, and I'd get a call on my cell phone and it'd be Roy in my backyard saying, hey, I got a fish out here. And I, well, you know, take it off the hook. Nope, not gonna do it. Yep, it's gonna die. You better come out here and get it. And I'd have to run out there and take it off the hook.
And he had a touchdown on the hook, but it was a little bit too long for his fishing buddy, Roy Williams. I bet they have a pretty nice spread there in Franklin Lakes, New Jersey. The lake back in the backyard.
Yeah,
Sims Lake, we're told Chris calls it, and stocked with bass. Roy likes to catch the fish. He just doesn't like to do anything else really related to fishing.
As you said here, Sims lets one get off the hook. This is a touchdown. That's a tough touch right there. Post ball, and Waddell, number 18, beat again.
How about right on cue during the interview? Talks about a cell phone would ring, and then a cell phone rings. 2nd and 10. Benson again, and a flag down as there was some pushing and shoving after the play. Holloway got tangled up with Kendall High. If time permits, stay tuned for the Thrifty Car Rental post-game report featuring scores and highlights from around the country.
You know, Sean,
after the play, personal foul on Texas. 13 yards, 3rd down.
You know, Sean, talking Chris Sims, he only has 13
passes in this game, and I think that's the way it's going to be this year with the running game and the talent of this offensive line. He's going to be called upon to hit balls to the outside against man-to-man coverage, and while he's not going to get as many attempts as other quarterbacks across the country, he's going to get a chance to hit big balls and go for big yards down the field in those opportunities.
Chris, under 50% of the game now, 12 for 26, but there have been a number of drops, and they've thrown down the field a lot too, which would make it more difficult to complete a higher percentage. Setting up a screen, Brett Robin. Got stacked up at the 37-yard line, well short of a first down. Robin's an excellent student, pre-med student at UT. His dad, Sid's a doctor. They went to Africa together over the summer to provide medical care literally to thousands of people. They'd see hundreds of people a day. You can imagine the urgent need for medical care in parts of Africa. Brett said he always had an appreciation for what a fine doctor his dad was, but had even more of an appreciation when they went together to Africa. Brett would like to be a team physician someday. Brian Bradford will punt to Michael Waddell with 8.5 minutes left. Straight up in the air. Infield fly rule in effect. It takes a bounce. It hit a Tar Heel. And it's recovered by Texas. Michael Ungar, a special team standout, wound up with the ball after it bounced off Michael Waddell. It would have been wise just to get away from it.
Yeah, forgettable night for Waddell. Beaten time and time again by some of these talented Texas receivers, and I have no idea what Waddell's doing near that punt as it lands. That is, I mean, he had to see the football.
Well, they seem to be looking at Chad Stevens instead.
That is really absent-minded play from your punt returner. And still enough time for North Carolina if they secure that punt to go into a clock status with over 8 minutes to go. You're down three scores, two touchdowns and a field goal, but still plenty of time. A lot stranger things have happened, and Waddell taking that opportunity away from his teammates.
Well, really a typical young and inexperienced team, North Carolina. They have flashes of brilliance, but they've just made way too many key mistakes. A pass incomplete intended for B.J. Johnson. Dropped it, but it appeared he was going to be out of bounds. David Norrie will watch with interest as we get this update from John Saunders at Times Square Stadium.
That's right, John. UCLA taking on Oklahoma State. Corey Paws looks like he's in a lot of trouble here as the pocket collapses, but he releases it just in time. Ryan Smith, that guy all over him, still comes up with a touchdown. 25 yards, 31-10 at that point. They win 38-24.
Bob Toledo has to be excited. Colorado State had that team on the ropes late last week. Bruins came up with a win.
You're an alum. Paws is putting up numbers as you used to when you quarterbacked the Bruins.
Got to keep an even keel.
Sims zings one for Roy Williams. A short gain to the 16-yard line. They're still winging it. Up by 17 with under 8 minutes remaining now. Well, speaking of winging it, the fun and gun on display for the first time on Monday Night Football. Steve Spurrier's taking his act to the NFL. Al Michaels and John Madden will be in Washington to watch the revamped Redskins take on the Philadelphia Eagles. That's Monday night at 9, 6 Pacific on ABC. Of course, another aspect of that game, the Pro Bowl middle linebacker Jeremiah Trotter left the Eagles, went to the Redskins in the offseason.
Heartbreaker for the Eagles against the Titans last week.
Sims alertly letting the play clock run down to 2 before he took the snap. Pump fake for Williams. This time Waddell broke it up. Williams wanted a flag. That one a little bit underthrown, it appeared, from Sims.
Not a memorable game for Waddell, but you can't play the fade pattern against Roy Williams any better than that. And give some credit to number 18. He's still fighting, scratching and clawing late in this ball game.
Surprised up by 17 and just trying to kill the clock. They threw three straight passes, two of them incomplete.
Well, I'll tell you what, they're only up by 17 points. That is not running up the score. You want to take a shot outside.
No, I'm just thinking about, you know, if you want to try to run more time off the clock.
If you're going to throw the football down the field, there isn't a safer play than putting it up for Roy Williams. if you're going to put it up, at least put it up into the end zone where it doesn't have a chance to be returned for a touchdown.
A 33-yard field goal try by Dusty Mangum, wide left. Well, that was a horrible possession. They didn't take much time off the clock, and then they missed a short field goal. New Tuesday at 8, 7 Central, John Ritter and Katie Sagal are Married with Kids in the new comedy, 8 Simple Rules for Dating My Teenage Daughter. That's Tuesday at 8, 7 Central on ABC. I remember your former coach and my former broadcast partner, Terry Donahue, had one simple rule for dating his daughters. You don't.
That makes it simple. And Sean, I got to give you some credit as my partner. That, when you go with two incomplete passes, I mean, a lot stranger things have happened. And see a new quarterback here in the football game, C.J. Stevens, but still time for a clock drive here.
And Stevens' first pass nearly intercepted by Rod Babers, who just cannot hang on to the football. Stevens, a junior from Gainesville, Florida. He's a transfer from the University of Florida. Grew up in Gainesville as his dad, Jimmy Ray, a longtime assistant on Steve Spurrier's staff. His best friend, Rex Grossman, that's also the reason why he transferred largely, because he knew with Rex Grossman ahead of him, he wasn't likely to play. He took one snap at Florida, redshirted in 99, took one snap in a game in 2000. Now he drops this snap and gets it back. Stevens came off the bench and played well in relief of Durant against Miami of Ohio in brief action. Here's John Saunders again at Times Square Stadium.
Sean, just here to let you know that Joe Paterno has yet another victory to add to number one. Frank Solich, his team played horrendously. It's the worst loss for Nebraska in 12 years. 40-7 is the final. Johnson, 19 carries for 123 yards and a couple of touchdowns. Sean, all done there.
John, well done. Good night to you and Terry. All in all, a pretty good day for the Big Ten, David. They had a lot of showdown games. Penn State annihilates Nebraska. Ohio State beats Washington State. And Michigan, if they could have earned that victory against Notre Dame, they'd be calling this the best day for the Big Ten in many a year in the regular season.
Oh, so close. And I think Michigan's going to need some better play out of Navarre if they're going to vie for the Big Ten championship, especially the way that Ohio State and Penn State are playing right now. And you got some other teams like Wisconsin in the mix. Navarre's going to have to step it up some.
How about Michigan State? It was part of the down part of the day for the Big Ten, getting beaten by Cal in East Lansing. Jason Brown injured and walking off. C.J. Stevens broke all of Doug Johnson's records in high school at Buchholz in Gainesville. Of course, Doug Johnson went on and started for the Florida Gators. C.J.'s dad, Jimmy Ray, with the departure of Steve Spurrier, has left Florida and is now coaching at Tennessee. Looks like going from the Hatfield to the McCoys in the SEC. The pass incomplete, intended for Sam Aiken. Reed Boyd, the middle linebacker, blitzed the quarterback.
Facing this defense is a little different than going up against Miami of Ohio, although you got to give Miami some credit for pulling off the upset here at Chapel Hill. C.J. Stevens learning on the fly and a baptism by fire from the Longhorns.
Here's John Lafferty to punt. And Vasher back deep. He hasn't really been able to get loose yet today. They've had good coverage, and on other times there have been poor punts. Been so short, he hasn't had a chance to return the punt. This one, a 40-yard punt and no return. And the Longhorns will take over near the 44-yard line as we look at the Pacific Life game summary. Sims has thrown for 298 and 4 touchdowns. Benson did most of his damage in the first half. And an up-and-down day for Durant. He'll long remember the two interceptions in the end zone.
Texas showed me no reason to continue to think that they're going to be right there in the mix for that national championship game against maybe Miami. Miami looks awfully good in that slot. Durant, I think this team And Chapel Hill has a lot to build upon with him at quarterback. He showed a lot of skill running the football and passing.
Breaking free, Cedric Benson. Finally knocked out of bounds near the 20-yard line. 39 yards on the run. Jeff Longhaney, a backup linebacker, redshirt freshman from Wade, North Carolina, prevented a touchdown.
And how about this offensive line for Texas? They've been dominant at times in this football game, and it's the type of run that Cedric Benson looks back on with a smile, because it not only gives you something to look back on favorably, but it also pads your stats a little bit, and he deserves it. He's had a nice night. I get more and more impressed with all the film that I watch on number 32.
Little shake and bake again inside the five, touchdown. That gets Benson over 200 yards rushing. And the Longhorns lead 44-21 with the extra point still to come. .208, just under his career best, which is 213 yards. For 213 last season against Kansas. The extra point from Dusty Mangum, good. And with 6:04 remaining, John Bunting and the Tar Heels are down 45-21.
Cedric Benson is so subtle with his running style. He's not incredibly big. He doesn't have amazing speed, but what a feel from that tailback position with his vision. Great cutting ability. He just steps through tackles. I mean, you got to get a piece of this kid if you're going to bring him down.
He's had a strange game. Benson rushed for 115 in the first half, had 0 yards rushing in the third quarter, and has gained 93 here in the fourth quarter on 8 carries.
To be fair to North Carolina, controlled the ball a little bit, controlled the clock in that third quarter, and I think that Texas and also the offensive coordinator Greg Davis got away from what they did well in the first half and some of their play calling. And when they went back to Cedric Benson, he paid dividends.
Richmond McGee to kick off. He's a petroleum engineering major. Wallace Wright back for the kickoff, but he couldn't field it. Wallace Wright, a special team standout last week for his performance on special teams up at Syracuse. He was one of their team recipients of the Chip on the Shoulder Award. That's something that John Bunting has started this season. He wants his team to play with a chip on the shoulder, with an attitude, all out, 100% intensity all the time. And for a guy who plays with that intensity level, with that aggressiveness, he's going to receive a chip, which is actually a big block of wart. He picked it up yesterday. It's heavy. That's the one won by Jaquish Dumas last week.
You could throw
it's
the
about
ball.
14, 16 inches across and about an inch thick. And it came from trees that were cut down behind Keenan Fieldhouse, the old building to our right. They're making way for some parking spaces, so some trees were cut down. John Bunning sent some personnel over there to pick up the wood. Every week he's giving out two or three of those chips on the shoulder. I hope they don't cut down any more trees here, because one of the features of this stadium, you really feel like you're in among the trees, because you are when you come into Keenan Stadium.
Absolutely beautiful setting. One of the nicest across the country.
Low throw for Andre Williams. Stevens a little bit inaccurate, but he basically has not seen game action since high school, which was back in 1998.
You know, Sean, I could throw it around a little bit when I played, but I was never a candidate for a chip on the shoulder award, I can assure you that. I don't think I could even pick one of those up back when I was playing.
Well, John Bunting, it's been a gradual process here. He's thrown players off the team. He has a three-strike policy. You mess up three times in school, on the field, whatever the case may be, you're out. And he's thrown some good players off. Bosley Allen who was one of their best wide receivers last year. About 39 balls. He's now at Sam Houston State. And by his own admission, he did screw up a number of times. He said he didn't blame Coach Bunning for throwing him off. John Bunning says, I want people to play hard but do the right things, are disciplined, represent this university that I love in the proper manner at all times. And when you think of the horror stories we hear year after year around college athletics in some places where the inmates seem to run the asylum and get away with it, that's not going to happen here with Sheriff John Bunting on the watch.
Oh, it's interesting to hear. He said he faced a little heat with the recruiting class that he signed and some criticism, and he said, hey, I think they're off to a great start. And when we asked him about that great start, the first thing he mentioned is that they were consistent and solid in the classroom. And that's the first time I've ever heard that from a head coach in a meeting before a game. And I think it's a great thing. I really do.
He says we're still not all the way there yet in terms of the attitude. We still have a few who need to get on board, but it's getting closer. Timeout, North Carolina. Sean McDonough, David Norrie back in Chapel Hill. 5:12 remaining. What was the second largest crowd in stadium history. There's now a largely tailgating crowd out in the parking lots around Keenan Stadium. Here's the road ahead for Texas. Houston and Tulane and Oklahoma State before the game that all Longhorn fans are pointing toward. Oklahoma in Dallas on October 12th.
And the big difference this year is they've got to line up against Nebraska and Kansas State, both at their places, and of course the big rivalry game against A&M. But if you look for a tailor-made national championship type schedule, they probably got it last year. It's going to be a tougher road this year, but again, I think the Longhorns have all the weapons.
Mac Brown thinks they have a better team this year. Not a great punt by Lafferty. The expectation level always high at Texas, and we spoke with Mac Brown about that yesterday.
We want to win the national championship. That's our expectation, not just our fans. That's not a bad thing to want. I mean, it's not bad for your fans to want you to win all the games. We think that's a good thing. But if we're not good enough, let's try to get better each week. Don't play out of fear. Don't play out of concern that you might mess it up, because you're not going to get there. You better have a passion. You better enjoy yourself. I want our kids playing with a lot of fun, a lot of enthusiasm, and I want them to be aggressive. Let's go for it. If you mess it up, shoot, we'll go back to Austin and get ready and go next year.
First and 10, and a new quarterback and a new running back. Chance Mock handed the ball off to Selvin Young, the true freshman. Mock, a sophomore from the Woodlands, Texas, near Houston. Pet dog Sassy, and he has a terrific arm. We spoke with Greg Davis. He said Mock doesn't have much experience, but he's talented, has a great arm, is mobile, just doesn't have any playing time. And they're very excited about the future of Selvin Young as well. He's the backup to Benson as a true freshman. He slips. You know, talking with Mack Brown yesterday, he said it wasn't all that emotional coming back here to Keenan Stadium, because he comes back to North Carolina a lot. He and his wife, Sally, still have a home in the mountains of North Carolina. They have children who live in this area. He said, I'm back around this stadium 4 or 5 times a year in the summertime. He loved it here. He didn't think he would leave. He wasn't looking to leave. He had teams calling him over the years, and the closest he came to leaving was in 1994 when Oklahoma called. He had ties to Oklahoma, but his brother Watson was at Oklahoma at the time as an assistant and was a candidate for the head coaching job, so he didn't want to pursue it. Had some NFL teams approach him, but he really wasn't looking to leave. There's Young for the first down, and when Texas first called, he didn't think he'd go there either. But they offered him an 8-year deal at about twice the money he was making here. That got his attention, certainly, but he said what really convinced him to go was when he got the call from one of his coaching idols, Darryl Royal, who said, Coach, I want you to come coach the Longhorns. And he felt like he couldn't say no to Darryl Royal, and he left behind a beautiful $55 million football building to our left.
Yeah,
Alvin Young. Even though he's a freshman, you can see he intentionally went down to stay in bounds. Heads up play with the Longhorns way ahead. Tommy Davis made the tackle. Of course, the money wasn't that big an issue because Mac's wife, Sally, was doing exceptionally well in the real estate business.
You know, the money always helps. And no matter what coaches say, you have Rick Neuheisel, he leaves Colorado for Washington, said it wasn't the money. But I think the money always plays into it somewhat. But the Daryl Royal aspect of it and saying, hey, the reason why you should come here, Mac Brown, is because we need you. That's the toughest quest to turn down, and Mac Brown has returned this program to the upper echelon, to the mix in the BCS, and he's done it in a hurry.
Young on second down might have another first down inside the 35-yard line, under 3 minutes remaining. Clay Roberson and Dexter Reed combined on the tackle.
I mean, Sean, it's almost not fair, the facilities that they have down at Texas. Everything that you see down in Austin on campus is designed for recruiting. And I think Mac Brown's recruiting machine is the best in college football right now. It's going to be awfully tough in the Big 12 year in, year out to compete with this guy.
Well, the recruiting class in 99 is regarded by many as one of the greatest of all time when they brought in the national offensive player Sims and defensive player of the year Redding in the same class and a lot of other talent. And their most recent recruiting class, rated by many number one in the nation. There's a lot to sell there. Austin is a great city. It's a fine university with outstanding facilities, great tradition, excellent coaching. Next Saturday, join ABC Sports for another great day of college football. You'll see number 9 Virginia Tech head into Aggieland to battle number 23 Texas A&M or other regional action. That's next Saturday at 3:30 Eastern, 12:30 Pacific on ABC Sports, the class of college football. I think these are two very similar universities in that regard. Great public institutions, outstanding academics, beautiful campuses, outstanding football facilities. Of course, Mac had a hand in both football facilities.
Tough to turn down an admission to Chapel Hill or Austin.
Young is going to score his first collegiate touchdown. ...30 yards on the run by Selvin Young, the true freshman from Houston. And the route is on, and the final score certainly is not going to reflect the challenge that the Tar Heels presented. Down by 10, well into the second half.
Like most of these Longhorns players on the two deep chart, Young very highly recruited out of the Houston area. And his style of running is scarily similar for opponents to that of Cedric Benson. And he's got Benson-like talent.
The extra point up and good by Mangum. A minute and a half remaining. 52-21 Texas. Tonight, Chevrolet players of the game are Chris Sims from Texas and Jock Lewis from North Carolina. In recognition of their efforts, Chevrolet will make a $1,000 contribution to each university's general scholarship fund. I want the people around Austin who give Chris Sims a hard time to explain to me why. I mean, I know they love Major Applewhite, and understandably so. Major was a great player, a terrific person, and still is. Doing a great job, by the way, on the radio down there in Austin, Texas, hosting a show with Kevin Dunn. They are very, very knowledgeable. What a chance to be on their show this week. Major's doing that while he finishes his schoolwork. He's going to go back into coaching. But Chris Sims is also a terrific person, very intelligent, a great player. Chris admitted yesterday some of them may not like him because he's a Yankee from New Jersey. And others, of course, just preferred Applewhite. But the extent of the criticism that he's taken from some, it's a little hard to understand.
Chris Sims coming off that Big 12 championship game, and I can understand the disappointment. They had a great shot. They win that ball game. They go on to the national championship game. Applewhite, all-time leading passer in Texas history, but I think Sims has an incredibly bright future, and you may just see him down in Tempe in early January.
The executive producer of ABC Sports is Howard Katz. Senior producer of ABC Sports, Bob Toms. Coordinating producer of college football, Bob Goodrich. Our telecast tonight from Chapel Hill, produced by Jim Ressler, directed by Jeff Wynn. Technical director, Reggie Wade. First and 10. Steven Still at quarterback, play action pass. Under pressure, throws it up for grabs. Somehow he found his target, the tight end Zach Hilton. Associate director tonight, Jim Maloney. Production manager, Megan Murray. Technical manager, Hal Schmitz. Assistants to the producer, David Fowler and Tony Rose. Computer stats, Anthony Holman. Spotter, Chris Helen. Statistician, Joe Sullivan. Stage manager, Troy Henderson. And director of production, Mark Loomis. Our thanks to all and the many others on our technical crew who braved a lot of foul weather here today to set up everything for tonight's telecast. Stevens throws a little low for Zach Hilton. It'll be second and 10.
There's been one surprise tonight for me watching this North Carolina offense is the lack of tight end play and getting the tight ends involved. Hilton, both Hilton and Bobby Blizzard, big games last week, and they've been absent pretty much the whole evening.
Stevens in trouble. Miraculous escape. Oh my goodness. Five white shirts coming after him. Four of them got to him. And a sack all the way back to the 20-yard line. Garnett Smith and Ryan Pickrell leading that charge.
This team speed for Texas. If you make a defender miss, you know that more are coming in a hurry. And Stevens just experienced that. Team defensive speed on this outfit might be the best in the country, along with Miami, maybe Florida State.
This might be the last play. 10 seconds left. Andre Williams out to the 26-yard line. A successful return to Chapel Hill for Mack Brown. Chris Sims threw four touchdown passes, 298 yards passing. Cedric Benson ran for 208 yards. Once again, the final score, Texas 52, North Carolina 21. ABC Sports is online at ESPN.com, keyword ABC Sports. And don't forget Monday night. It's the Philadelphia Eagles and the Washington Redskins on ABC's Monday Night Football.